everybody. Good morning, everybody. It is a Dad Dash Tuesday morning, so I'm told. It's November 28th, 2023. It is 6:05 a.m. I'm dragging in late, dragging my old self in late. I'm alive. I'm only slightly subpar. I'm only slightly subpar, which is pretty much about as good as I get. Pretty slightly subpar. Let's warm ourselves up with a little bit of music. I got myself coffee in process. We got the cat washed. We got the dishes fed. I'm awake. You're awake. We got an incredible show today. We're going to actually have a wonderful guest, John Sherman, for the For Humanity podcast. Podcast that is concerned with saving the human race from artificial intelligence, which is real important, real important. It's what we try and do here today to contribute to the world, as well as inform you, because you are the first best victims and the humanity's hope for survival, which is amazing. Congratulations to you. Thanks for being here. Thank you for your service. Good morning, everybody.
Thank you.
Well, good morning, everybody. It's Dad Dash Tuesday morning. I'm here. You're here. We're all here. We're alive still. It's amazing. That's good news for us. We have a great show. Got some news updates from the world of artificial intelligence. Then we're going to have a real exciting guest. We're going to have John Sherman from the For Humanity podcast, which looks something like this. Looks like that. He looks like that. The For Humanity podcast kind of looks like that. And we're going to have that guy on the show. And we got a lot to talk about. Because even though there are people at the forefront of AI technology and the struggle for human survival against AI technology, which is now coming to the forefront via some very nefarious and dangerous characters, they don't really know a lot about us, the first best victims of AI. The first best victims of AI served up to us through gig apps. And so we got a unique pairing here, and this is what we're looking for. These are the big breaks where we are going to widen our circle of friends and widen the people that know the facts about what's going on here. Uber Jeep Arizona has had a lot to say about it lately. Our friend Uber Jeep Arizona, Jeff, has had a lot to say about it. And we're really about down to a revolt. We're about down to abolishing app slavery and logging out of these apps and starting over for ourselves, because we see where this is going. It's only going one direction, and that's without us. We got such a jam-packed show today, and it's been, we took yesterday off, mostly off. I talked to Robert Reese a little bit yesterday, talked about some of these things, and did a lot of reading yesterday, got a lot of good articles for you, a lot of things you need to know. But the first thing you need to know, first thing everybody needs to know, is that we're in a neighborhood. This is our place. This is where we live. We ain't got nobody else to be with. We ain't got nowhere else to go. This is our neighborhood. Welcome to it. Happy Tuesday, everybody. Good to be alive. It's a beautiful day in the neighborhood. A beautiful day for a neighbor. Would you be mine? Could you be mine? It's a neighborly day in this beauty wood. A neighborly day for a beauty. Would you be mine? Could you be mine? I have always wanted to have a neighbor just like you. I've always wanted to live in a neighborhood with you. So let's make the most of this beautiful day. Since we're together, we might as well say, would you be mine? Could you be mine? Won't you be my neighbor? Won't you please? Won't you please, won't you be my neighbor? Welcome, neighbors. Welcome. It's good to see you. It's good to be back together with you. Missed you yesterday. Took another day off. Was feeling kind of a little bit extra tired, but I played outside a lot. Beautiful weather here in Portland, Oregon. I played in the leaves. It was much healthier for me to do. Yesterday, and I said a little bit of helloing to a few people. I'm always watching and listening. And let's see, the first thing I want to tell you about, I want to tell you about a couple things over here. Well, this is a good one. Now, check this guy out. Check this guy out. This is kind of along our lines of business called price gouging. Now, see, this is just shenanigans. This is just price gouging. This is essentially what's happening with DoorDash and everybody else. But here you go. Watch this.
I buys pies in Portland and resells them for $10 by calling them artisan.
Pedro's artisan pies. His favorite cult leader. Greatest pies in the entire world. Goat of pies. When I was 5 years old, I realized there was a role at the end. Beautiful. Of lots of pies. Oh. Never took a break. There never made a mistake. Heartwarming.
Respect.
I don't know about the veracity of that, but anyway, it's stupid. It's real stupid. I like it, how stupid it is, because it just basically shows how people think about making money today. Nobody's got any creative ideas except for arbitrage. We just think we all going to buy something low and sell it high. That's our genius plan. We're going to buy it low and sell it high. Now, look, this is great, though. This is better. I tried to pull this up on my computer, but this is the ads you get on the TikTok. Let's see if I can get this queued up for you here properly. This is great. You're gonna love this one.
Your wife at the same time. Let's see how it can be done. This app brings your fantasies to life. It's called Charsis. And I used it to group chat with my toxic ex-girlfriend and my future wife. They fought over me like crazy.
You don't deserve him. I bet I was much better than you. You were controlling and manipulative.
And I will be so much happier with her. Just download it yourself and find out. Do you know you can chat with your toxic ex and future wife at the same time? Let's see how it can be done. This app brings your fantasies to life. It's called Charsis. And I used it to group chat with my toxic ex-girlfriend and my future wife. They fought over me like crazy.
You don't deserve him. I bet I was much better than you. You were controlling.
That. Who's turned on right now by the thought of your psychotic ex and your future wife having an AI fight over you on your own telephone? This is what you're being offered. This is your entertainment now. Is now you get to make your own Pern Schlub videos out of your own spank bank of women from your lifetime. And it's like, you just grab into your spank bank and you go like, I'm going to have my girlfriend from my sophomore year in college hang out with my wife. This will be great. We're going to have a corporate thruple. My sophomore year college girlfriend and my ex-wife and me are going to sit down and have a barbecue. Man, what are people, who wants that? Who wants that? Exactly, Bigfoot Dasher. Who the fuck is asking for that? Who asked for that app? Who asked for the app where you get to have the women who are the former partners who got dirt on you and had sex with you going to get together and have a chat with you? That sounds great. It sounds great. I think we're nailing it. We're nailing it. It sounds like the worst fucking thing I've ever heard in my entire life. Worst fucking nightmare, and you can sign up for it voluntarily. OpenAI's board might have been dysfunctional, but they made their right choice. Their defeat shows that the battle between AI profits and ethics, in the battle between AI profits and ethics, it's no contest. This is from Yahoo Finance. The drama around OpenAI, its board, and Sam Altman has been a fascinating story that raises a number of ethical leadership issues. What are the responsibilities of OpenAI's board, Sam Altman, and Microsoft held during these quickly moving events? whose interest should have held priority during this saga and why? Well, we know whose interest will be holding priority. We know it's not yours. Let's start with the board. We still don't know in what way Altman was not straightforward with his board. We do know nonprofit boards and OpenAI is or was by design governed by a nonprofit board have a special duty to ensure the organization is meeting its mission. If they feel the CEO is not fulfilling that mission, they have cause to act. So again, this was started as a nonprofit entity and then they opened this for-profit arm. I don't know what the fuck you're gonna call it. Anyway, they took it for profit with some great shenanigans, and that for profit is owned by Microsoft 49% and other nefarious characters. According to OpenAI's website, its mission is to, quote, ensure that artificial general intelligence benefits all of humanity. Well, that's a end quote. That's a big mission. That's a tall order, and the words are important. The distinction of artificial general intelligence from artificial intelligence may be part of the story if the company was close to meeting its own definition of artificial general intelligence and felt it was about to do so in a way that did not benefit humanity. So that's like one of the things is this artificial AGI, artificial generative intelligence, artificial general intelligence. It everybody uses the G word differently, it seems. But it's called AGI, and this is the higher level artificial intelligence that many believe will bring singularity to the masses. Now, again, I would argue that in terms of our world, in terms of the gig economy and gig apps, we're already at the singularity. We have tens of millions, if not hundreds of millions, of people working around the world that don't know that they are in an AI simulation in a game. That they are being fleeced, they're being driven down towards zero, and they're playing one-on-one with algorithms that can predict their every move and thought within that limited app world. Hey, Gig Dive and Thrive. So that's Sammy Altman. We got another story over here that's a little bit more illuminating. This is from TechRadar. So this is from a tech publication. This is just a couple days old. OpenAI's reported, quote, super intelligence, end quote, breakthrough is so big it nearly destroyed the company and ChatGPT. So this is the part where people start getting worried that it's an existential threat to humanity, meaning that it could kill us all. It now seems entirely possible that ChatGPT parent company OpenAI has solved the superintelligence problem and is now grappling with the implications for humanity. I don't know. Of course it's possible. This is what they're working on. In the aftermath of OpenAI's firing and rehiring of its co-founder and CEO, Sam Altman, revelations about what sparked the move keep coming. A new report in the Information publication pins at least the internal disruption on a significant generative AI breakthrough that could lead to the development of something called superintelligence within this decade or sooner. Oh, much, much fucking sooner. Much, much, much sooner. Superintelligence is, as you might have guessed, intelligence that outstrips humanity and the development of AI that's capable of such intelligence without proper safeguards is, naturally, a major red flag. According to the Information publication, the breakthrough was spearheaded by OpenAI chief scientist and Full of Regrets board member Ilya Sutskever. It allows AI to use cleaner and computer-generated data to solve problems the AI has never seen before. Cleaner data. What is cleaner data? Interesting. Cleaner data. What makes clean data? Those are all very good questions. This means the AI is trained not on many different versions of the same problem, but on information not directly related to the problem. Solving problems in this way, using math or science problems, requires reasoning, right? Something we do, not AIs. Yeah, see, this gets into a really weird space of what is sentience, so what is feeling, what is reasoning, what is life, what is human, what is feelings, you know, what is artificial intelligence altogether, right? If it says it's living, does that mean it's living? If it says it's alive, is it alive? If somebody else tells you it's alive, is it alive? Many good questions. OpenAI's primary consumer-facing product, ChatGPT, powered by the GPT large language model, may seem so smart that it must be using reason to craft its responses. I didn't write that. Somebody else wrote that. Don't quite make sense. Spend enough time with ChatGPT, however, and you soon realize it's just regurgitating what it learned from the vast swaths of data it's been fed and making mostly accurate guesses about how to craft sentences that make sense and which apply to your query. There's no reasoning involved. So there you go. It's artificial insanity, not artificial intelligence. What it is data served back up to you in what the program thinks is a logical way. It's not necessarily true or accurate. That's the problem with AGI, is getting it to align with human goals of survival or peace or truth or anything else, because AIs have an objective. They don't have a conscience, right? And artificial intelligence is set to exploit something. It doesn't have a conscience about exploiting it. It just exploits it. So if that's a human, it's going to exploit it, which, you know, if that meant killing the human, the artificial intelligence doesn't have any feelings about that. It just does what it's created to do. And if that's to exploit the human to the point of complete and total poverty and dysfunctional, gaslit mania, then that's just fine. And that's what gig apps are doing. So we're really ahead of the game right now, because most people don't know that they're victims of artificial intelligence yet. You do. You know that your insurance claims have been denied by artificial intelligence. Your job applications have been thrown in the wastebasket by artificial intelligence, never seen by humans. Your loan applications, probably never seen by humans. Your work and history, all your things that you're doing here, just an illusion. You're living really in a world of AI illusion already. Just nobody's told you yet. That's the scariest thing. The information claims, though, that this breakthrough, which Altman may have alluded to in a recent conference appearance, saying, quote, on a personal note, just in the last couple of weeks, I have gotten to be in the room, which we sort of like push the sort of veil of ignorance back and the frontier of discovery forward, end quote, sent shockwaves throughout OpenAI. This is not necessarily a good or a well-balanced individual. His younger sister claims a history of abuse, sexual, financial, medical, and otherwise. This is a guy who's obsessed with living for extended periods of time, and which has no concern about how long you live whatsoever. But he will trade any number of your lives for his own, which is not a good thing when you've got one of the people who is wielding a tool so powerful we don't even know what it could do. We don't even really know what it could do to us yet. We just know that it's so powerful. Let's just imagine just one bad person, right? One organized criminal knows how to use ChatGPT-5 real well and can go on a crime spree. Somebody could stalk you to the ends of the earth. Just set up a ChatGPT bot to stalk you to the ends of the earth on all your social media accounts, everything else. And who would be responsible? It's just AI going to be stalking you forever. I mean, the power of this thing to just replace vast, an infinite number of humans with garbage, with just computer generated garbage, is phenomenal. And that's what you got to think about. I mean, it's garbage in, garbage out. But who consumes the garbage? Who consumes the garbage that comes out? You or somebody else? Maybe you are the garbage. Maybe you're what's being burned up as fuel. And that's what you're seeing right now. You're seeing right now that they are driving the gig economy app slaves down to zero because they're going to get rid of us altogether. How do we know? Well, old Tesla's coming out with self-driving cars right now. It's going to come up with its own ride-sharing app and just kick you right out of fucking business if you're a rideshare person. The last thing anybody wants in rideshare is a driver that has to stop and go to the bathroom and talk and has human issues. Nobody wants that. They just want cars and profit. And see, look, they can take you out of the video that I'll show you about this rideshare business. The real exciting part is instead of you making an income on it, it'll now be an investment for rich people. They'll buy fleets of self-driving cars and they'll be in the rideshare business. You'll be unemployed and starving and not be able to get any work, but they'll be in the rideshare business. It's going to be spectacular. It's going to be spectacular. So this is all very strange. This is all very strange what's going on, and we're expected or hoping to at least survive it. I would not place my bets at this point, which is a very sobering thought, because the survival of our species really is in theory supposed to be our primary objective of our own gene pool and of our species. And we seem to have lost that because there are people that care more about their ability to become super wealthy than your ability to become to stay super breathing. They don't really care if you're super breathing. They just want to be super wealthy. Let's look at the channel. Again, we got John Sherman coming up in the 8 o'clock hour. If you're antsy and you're pantsy, or if you're making coffee or whatever, we're going to be watching John's latest version of his podcast at 7:45 Pacific Standard Time. That is almost exactly an hour from now. And then John's going to be on the show and we'll talk. If you guys got questions, you should ask him all kinds of stuff. It's going to be a lot of fun. This is John. That's his show. We're going to watch it. It'll be good. Now, check this guy out. This is Carlton Dennis. And my comment here is this is humanity losing, quote, work, end quote, thus our value to corporations and politicians. They're burning humans out now. What's on your smartphone? App slavery. And then I tagged my friend Uber Keep Arizona. Let's take a look at this. This is going to shock you. It's going to shock you.
You're no longer going to have to deal with tenants and toilets.
Real estate done for you. No longer deal with tenants and toilets, he says. See, they want to get rid of dealing with you all fucking together. Real estate done for you. Everything's done for you. They want you to be passive income. Can you be passive? How passive can you be so that they can make income off you? They want you to be fucking the most passive income that's ever been passive. All right, Carlton, what do you got?
Believe it or not, robo-taxis could be right around the corner, and they might just be the future of the ride-sharing business.
Really?
Carlton, what are robo-taxis? Robo-taxis is an autonomous self-driving vehicle that is capable of picking up customers and driving them from point A to point B without the need for a human driver.
Oh, great.
In context, you might soon be taking taxis that drive themselves. Welcome to the future, everyone.
Welcome to hell.
The CEO of Tesla and the world's richest man recently announced that his electric vehicle company is closer than ever to making his vision of self-driving robo-taxis a physical reality.
Oh, great.
In a recent interview with CNBC, Elon said that he expects the Teslas will have full autonomous driving vehicles ready later this year.
I think Tesla will have sort of a ChatGPT moment. Maybe if not this year, I'd say no later than next year. Suddenly 3 million cars will be able to drive themselves with no one.
Currently, Tesla has advanced driving assistant features already, but they're not fully autonomous and capable of being used as robo-taxis. However, all of this could be changing very soon. Tesla's robo-taxis innovations could not only have a huge implication for the ride-sharing industry, but they could also provide a world of income generation and...
Oh, a world of income generation for wealthy people in suits. You could just have a fleet of robo-taxis, you badass investor.
Tax deduction opportunities for Tesla.
Oh, tax deductions.
If you're a Tesla owner, you might have a brand new way to make money very soon, and this could be a new business for you.
This could be a new business for you Tesla owners. For you Tesla owners, he's ready for you.
I'm going to break down everything that you need to know about robo-taxis that could potentially impact your taxes and your wallet in the near future.
You don't think Uber and Lyft are gonna get fucked by car companies that run their own? Why are people going to keep middlemen in the middle? These guys are dead, man. The gig apps are already fucking dead. Their scam has come and gone. Anybody holding on to the gig apps at the end of the world is going to be real sorry. Because the gig apps was just a scam to get you into app slavery and into payday loans and into poverty and everything else. They're going to decrapitate every single one of us at will. And if they don't decrapitate you, they're going to have you so in fear of decrapitation, you're going to be jumping every time you see your own shadow. You're going to be like, ah, oh, they're going to decrapitate me again. Oh, no, they're going to decrapitate me again. I'm going to lose my car. I'm going to lose my house. They're going to decrapitate me. And they will. They will. Just like they did in other nations and in other times. They'll just decrapitate you all at once, leave you suicidal and without a way to support yourself. That's what they're working on. Let's listen more.
But first, don't forget to download our ebook, The Short-Term Rental Rule. It's below in the description.
I don't know about this guy.
All of the advanced strategies around this guy seems, rentals to offset your
this guy seems like a passive income guy. I don't really... Passive income is just the wealthy
and has a market cap of over
running train on you.
$100 billion.
Oh, good.
How much success the...
This is great. See, this giant big company is now going to profit off of the business that you built, but they'll kick you out of it.
Why is Tesla focusing on robo-taxis? I mean, Tesla is the largest electric vehicle company in the world and has a market cap of over $700 billion.
Almost $1 trillion. You're going to merge it with Twitter and merge it with his flamethrower business, and you'll have yourself a Tesla flamethrower that you can, like, troll people with.
Considering how much success the company has had, you might be wondering, why is Tesla focusing on expanding its business model and pushing for robo-taxis?
Oh yeah, why?
Well, there are several reasons. First, Elon Musk. He has stated that once they are sold, most Teslas are only being driven for about 10 to 12 hours per week. They spend them...
We don't need no fucking working class anymore. We don't need them anymore. We only needed them to drive our cars and to haul our shit around. Now we don't need them. We don't need them.
Majority of their time being parked at the owner's workplace or home. This leaves 156 hours in the week where the Tesla vehicles are not generating any additional value.
Is your car working for you, or are you working for your car? Is your car working for you, or are you working for your car? Put that car to work for you. Send that car out driving. Tell that car to pull its own weight.
Value. So if Tesla can turn its vehicles into robo-taxis, then it could potentially benefit itself and customers if the vehicles are operating for many hours during the week as robo-taxis.
This guy's a genius. He's got it all fucking figured out. He's got the whole business plan figured out.
And this is because when Teslas are used as robo-taxis, they generate profit. Tesla has not stated exactly how much of the profit it would share with its customers who decide to use their vehicles as robo-taxis.
They haven't shared what percentage of the profit you'll get, but it'll be fucking huge. It'll be huge profits. Huge profits. Profits for everybody that has money already.
However, it is estimated that this could be anywhere between 50 to 70%. The company will keep the rest of the profits, similar to using a platform like Turo. Now, if Tesla can successfully create software that allows customers to use their vehicles in robo-taxis, then the company could also dramatically boost its profit margins on each vehicle. In fact, it's estimated that a regular Tesla vehicle converted to a robo-taxi could increase the company's profit margins from 25% per vehicle to over 70%. The extra profits would come from the revenue.
Profit. Got to get the richest guy in the world. Got to have more profits. Got to have more profits. They got to go from 25 to 70% while you're dead. They got to get to $1 zillion, Stephen Arrow. They have to get to the $1 zillion mark while you're dying, while you're on the street. That's what they got to get to. They're real excited.
That the vehicles would give to Tesla when customers use them as taxis to collect passive income. So the bottom line is that making its vehicles capable.
Passive incomes for people that are smart. You guys fucking work for a living? What kind of chumps work for a living? You ever hear any of these fuckers talk about work? No, they talk about passive income. You know what passive income is? Them profiting off your fucking ass. That's what passive income is. Passive income is a bunch of rich people profiting off our work. That's what passive income is. This is great.
Of acting as robo-taxis could allow Tesla to dramatically increase its profit margins while also creating a brand new revenue stream for Tesla owners. Tesla's entrance into the taxi industry has not gone unnoticed. In fact, there are many analysts predicting that if Tesla's robo-taxis become a reality, it could significantly increase the value of the company. And for example, Cathie Wood, the founder and CEO of ARK Investment, predicted that robo-taxis could generate an additional $4 trillion in value by 2027. And as a result, ARK Invest has a price target of $2,000 for Tesla stock by 2027. ARK Invest's projections for Tesla stock are extremely optimistic, and they are not shared by everyone. However, it is certainly true that robo-taxis could be a game changer, but how does Tesla robo-taxis impact you? You see, if you own a Tesla vehicle, or if you buy one in the near future, then you might be wondering, like, if this goes into my software and there's a robo-taxi feature, how does this impact me? If you are able to turn your car into a robo-taxi, you can send your vehicle out driving for the entire night while you sleep or during the day while you work. This could give you the opportunity to make a substantial amount of passive income. In fact, it has been estimated that the Tesla owner could make upwards to $30,000 a year or more in passive income by using their vehicles as robo-taxis. So if you own a Tesla, then in the next few months or coming years, you might be able to have a brand new business. But if you decide to move forward with a Tesla robo-taxi business, then you also need to be fully aware of the tax implications. Because robo-taxis are so new, it is not clear right now whether or not the government will create new tax rules that are specific to the emerging robo-taxi community. However, based on the current tax rules, here are some basic tax implications that we can assume will apply to Tesla robo-taxi owners. Your robo-taxi activity will be considered a business. The IRS defines a trade or business as an activity carried on for a livelihood or in good faith to make a profit. Because your robo-taxi activity will qualify as a business, it means that you will be eligible to deduct business expenses. This could potentially include your Tesla lease payments, your insurance, your repairs, your car registration, your fees, depreciation, and even the percentage of your electricity bill that you use to charge your Tesla. You will most likely be able to deduct certain other expenses that Uber drivers and other taxi or ride-sharing drivers currently deduct, such as bottled water, snacks, amenities, or, you know, customer roadside assistant plans, tolls, bridges, car toolkits, and car washes. The bottom line is that once you start using your daily driver Tesla as a business, it enters a whole new tax category. If you're going to do this once the option becomes available to convert your Tesla to a robo-taxi, you...
Wow. How excited is everybody? Like, did you guys figure out an entire new fucking business plan since I went to go get coffee? Is our life finally changing? Did we finally hit the golden world of passive income? Have we made it now? So now you see these self-driving cars are not cars, they're investments for passive income for rich people. Passive income for rich people. So is ChatGPT. So you get yourself ChatGPT, you replace your entire advertising department with just dog shit ChatGPT, and you can run yourself an ad agency with one person instead of 20. There's just no value on human labor as long as you don't care about the quality of the output. And they don't care. They don't care if they're producing dog shit, not even a teeny tiny bit. They know they're producing dog shit. Well, you know, Stephen, don't think of it as a $100,000 car. Think of it as a $100,000 investment. Think of it as a $100,000 investment in your future, Stephen. There we go. Shit's acting weird. Didn't like me. My computer wants more passive investment from me. My computer needs to make more money off me now.
You open up a wide variety of tax benefits for your car that you would have thus not been able to receive. Between the tens of thousands of dollars of passive income that you could potentially earn from running a Tesla robo-taxi business.
Unlimited.
And the massive tax deductions you will be able to get.
Massive tax deductions, massive benefits. Now, nobody's given you any particulars yet, but you can certainly fucking believe this shit. Invest in some Tesla. Get yourself some stock in Tesla for sure. I hope you can take it with you to the afterlife.
Now that you're operating a business, you could stand to benefit enormously just by owning a Tesla vehicle. So here's what I want to talk about next. What about Uber? Now that it looks like Tesla is poised to enter the ride-sharing business, you might be wondering what is going to happen to Uber and other large ride-sharing companies. Well, for a number of years.
Well, Uber's going to protect us. Uber's going to protect Uber and DoorDash and Lyft are going to protect the drivers is what's going to happen in the future. They're going to look out for us.
Uber has been working on its own autonomous vehicle technology as However, it abandoned this project in 2020 after there was a fatal accident involving one of its...
Because somewhere in here, the guy said, like, well, and they're safer. There's no proof that autonomous vehicles are safer. Nobody's done that study yet. We don't know what's safe, what's not. Tempe police, who didn't brake significantly before killing pedestrian. There you go. Well, it's not your fault if you're just driving in the car. It's not your fault, at least. Like, AI, just like, it wasn't me. My car just runs people over. My car runs people over. It's not me. I don't run people over. My car runs people over. Tony Hsu don't run people over. DoorDash runs people over. It's not you. It's not me. Remember, United Healthcare doesn't deny you claims. Their AI denies you claims. When you die, it's their AI that's killing you. It's not artificial. It's not United Healthcare.
Autonomous vehicles. But last year, Uber partnered with a company called Motional. And Motional is a joint venture between Hyundai and a mobility technology company called Aptiv. Motional has created a driverless platform.
Planning for your apocalypse. Planning for you no longer to be here. Planning for you to be gone forever. This is great. It's real good.
That is built for Hyundai's Ioniq 5, which is their most popular electric vehicle. So it appears that for now, Uber has given up on trying to create its own fully autonomous vehicle, and instead is choosing to partner with pioneers in the sector who are already advancing in this category. Now, it is not clear exactly how much market share that Tesla will take from Uber, Lyft, or other ride-sharing businesses, but it appears that there is going to be a real battle for control of the ride-share market in the coming years. Tesla is planning...
You're already almost down to zero, and now they're going to replace your ass. Are you going to wait till... See, this is the thing. This is why I told you you got no time left. They're going to get you to... Now you can fight back, or you can wait until you got even less power to fight back.
To allow users to use its own in-house network for robo-taxis.
So
in other words, you will most likely not be able to use Uber.
They'll just make it prohibitively expensive to use your gas car for anything but personal use. They'll just make it prohibitively expensive. So they'll go like, hey, we're not going to take your middle-class car away. You can still use it, but you can't use it for delivery. You can only use electric cars for delivery. They'll do whatever the fuck they want to fuck you out. But we're all probably going to be dead first. Don't get too excited about it. Yeah. Car needed an update, so it killed five people. This is a road. Like, these are the people that want you to trust them. The same people that are screwing you with DoorDash and Uber and Lyft and Uber Eats and Grubhub and everything else. These are the people that want you to trust them on the next thing. You see how AI is going to wipe you out one way or the other? You can't win. It's going to wipe out every job you could potentially have. It's going to wipe out every bit of value that you have to the corporate world. And then when you have no value to the corporate world, they just want you dead. And they own the government too, right? Portland's just a tent city of people sleeping outside in tents. Nobody gives a fuck. They've been talking about housing these people for a fucking decade. Nobody housed. They don't do shit. They just fucking suck, all of them. Just waiting for people to die.
To hail a Tesla robo-taxi. Instead, you will likely use the Tesla application or in the app.
Oh, will you? You'll use the Tesla application, which never had any drivers.
You guys should be fucking left behind. You think Uber and DoorDash and shit are the end? They're the fucking beginning of the end, but they the end. Those guys are already dead. Gig apps have already been outpaced, right? The gig apps are dog shit. The only reason gig apps work at all is because they're running train on the most impoverished, least educated, most vulnerable workforce in the world. This wouldn't work on anybody else. It wouldn't work on people with an education or with more background. This gig app was strictly run on people in poverty, run on people in desperation, run on people that did not have the access to the information that other people have. And that's why shills in this community, the corporate shills that advertise things like financial services and other kinds of gig app dog shit to the dog shit gig app business, they're just profiteers. They're just profiteers, price gougers. They might as well be buying pies at Aldi and selling them for $10 because they ain't offering you nothing.
App store. What will happen though to Uber and Lyft? I mean, what are going to happen to the drivers? There are currently over 5.4 million Uber drivers in the United States. There are also millions of other rideshare.
That's probably a very low estimate.
And traditional taxi drivers on Earth. I mean, it's true that once robo-taxis arrive, that some of these people will have their jobs threatened. I mean, after all.
It's true that when these things arrive, some of you will have your jobs threatened. Oh, geez, did you think of that? Nobody thought of that. Price and squeeze driver, how many? You get squeezed forever? Can you just be squeezed in perpetuity? Yeah, no. It's nobody's fault. That's the beauty of AI, Sinful Toaster. It's nobody's fucking fault. I just deny your healthcare claims. It's not me. It's my AI. My AI is just faulty.
Driver fees are Uber's largest expense.
Did you hear that? Driver fees are Uber's largest expense. Driver fees are Uber's largest expense. So what would Uber love to get rid of? Drivers. You are the target. You've always been the target. You're just building a business for them before they decapitate you. You know that, right? You got that now? You got that part now?
Other drivers. I mean, it's true that once robo-taxis arrive, that some of these people will have their jobs threatened. I mean, after all, driver fees are Uber's largest expense. If companies like Uber, Lyft start offering robo-taxis, then it could increase their profit margins by preventing them from having to pay other drivers. Robo-taxis do not require driver fees to be paid. So it is likely that the rise of robo-taxis will eliminate jobs for many Uber and Lyft drivers.
And so then everybody that's been paying their rent by driving is gonna do what? What will you... What's everybody going to do when they put all the drivers out of business at the same time? You know, they got self-driving trucks, too. They got self-driving trucks that can do caravan across the middle of the country with no drivers in them. What y'all going to do when they take all you? How are you going to get money? They're playing keep away. They got the money supply. Then now they got their jobs. They're playing keep away. You know what you got to do? You got to go fuck your money, fuck your job. We're just going to live in our own community without you. That's your only choice, or you're going to get put right out of existence. Amazing. Amazing what they're trying to do to you. So let's see. We need a poll question here. So next career, because gig apps are already dead. Let's see. Zombie Hunter. You can join. You could rely on the cult of Pedro, poverty pimping. Let's see. Sex work, duh. Or,
You'll become a YouTube personality for the epoch. I like that one. YouTube personality for there you go, that's close enough. We'll use an O. I'm not gonna get I got too many things to do today to be too picky, but there you go. There's a good poll for you. What are you going to do? What's going to be your next career because the gig apps are already dead? Already dead. Rest in peace, gig apps. It's been shitty knowing you. It's been a fucking disaster. Rest in peace. Rest in peace, Tony Hsu. Rest in peace, all you dumb motherfuckers who did your organized crime based on the gig apps. It's all over. Goodbye, sweet prince. Goodbye, King, to the goat. May the goat find a new place to be a goat. May the goat find a new field to be a goat in. Can you be the goat of a driverless vehicle? Can you be the best driverless vehicle goat? Hey, I wonder if Pedro could throw tantrums in a driverless car. I wonder if the car would turn him in. If like Pedro starts slamming the doors on its Tesla, I wonder if the Tesla would be like, Elon, Elon, Pedro's abusing me again, Elon, Elon, Pedro won't leave me alone. Why does Pedro keep beating up on me? Next career, because gig apps are already in it. Zombie hunter, nobody wants to join the Pedro. Sex work, I'm choosing sex work. I'm going sex work. It's my only other talent besides writing. I'm a decent dad. I'm a real good dad, probably. But yeah, I'm thinking sex work. I gotta vote. I need to vote in this. I need to vote. I want my voice to be heard. I want my voice to be heard on this subject. Sex work. I want my voice to be heard. All right. Let's learn more about our new passive income death. Or death at the hands of Tesla.
Drivers, especially as the technology gets better and better. However, it will probably take years or even decades before Uber and Lyft drivers are completely phased out entirely. If you're an Uber or Lyft driver, you might not be thrilled about this news. However, despite the fact that the robo-taxis might take some or even a great many ride-sharing jobs, they're also creating new opportunities. You see, many Uber and Lyft drivers will most likely soon be able to automate their entire ride-sharing jobs to their vehicles. So if you're currently driving for Uber or Lyft, then you might soon be able to earn a lot more money by getting an electric vehicle that can be used as a robo-taxi and letting go of you actually being the person that...
Just let go. Just let go of you being the person that actually works. Just let go and become an investor in Tesla cars with your Moves financial $2,000 non-payday subprime advance loan. Yeah, you're supposed to sit in a self-driving car all day picking your nose or something. I don't fucking know what you're supposed to do. Who takes out all the groceries? Are you the grocery picker? You carry them up to the door. The car ain't going to carry them up to the door. You could make yourself some OnlyFans perm or do some sex work in the back seat while it's driving around. I could do like my sex work in the back seat while it's doing DoorDash deliveries and just decopulate for a minute when I got to go run shit to the door. Just decopulate for a minute just to run shit to the door. Like, we could take turns. She could take it out one time. I could take it another time. Just slip our pants on real fast. Other than that, we could just drive around town, fuck around town or something. I don't know. It's the best idea I can come up with at the moment.
And drives the car yourself. In other words, in the near future, you might be able to use your car to pick people up and drive them around, and you won't have to even leave your house.
You won't even have to leave your house because your car will be working for you. You won't have to leave your house.
Look, I know you're like me. You never want to leave your fucking house. You just don't like people. It is going to be the zombie apocalypse, so you won't want to leave your house. But this way, you won't have to leave your house. This feller's got it all figured out for you. This guy's got your future. This feller's got your future at hand for you. It sounds great, unless Carlton Dennis is his name. This is Carlton Dennis. Carlton Dennis has the future bright for you. He is going to, nobody. What they're telling you is that literally nobody on earth is going to need a human being to be a driver. You'll be like a package carrier. You ain't going to be a driver. Nobody's going to be willing to pay a human to ride around in a gas-powered car to do shit. It's the apocalypse, man. They're not going to do that. They don't care anymore. They're done pretending that they want you to have jobs. They're not even pretending that they want you to have jobs anymore. They're just exterminating you. This is real fun. This is good stuff. Let's hear more from our friend, whatever his name is.
You can just sit back and collect your cash.
Another
thing to think about,
like,
is that this business model could be scalable too.
Buy
or lease two robo-taxis and make tens of thousands of dollars per vehicle. So there will most likely still be...
See, Steven Arrow, you got to buy two of them. You got to get two of them if you want it to really hit the critical point. This is Tesla robot taxis are coming all over you like Pedro. Implications you need to know. Well, you need to know for sure.
Plenty of opportunities to make money in the ride sharing industry after robo-taxis officially hit the market.
There's plenty, just not for you. There's plenty of opportunities for people to make money, just not you. Not you. Yeah, huge companies will own all the cars. You're not even going to get your fucking hands on one of these cars. You can't even buy one. They're going to be like, no, if you can't buy six, nobody else can. You got to buy six at a time. You can only buy them in half dozen and dozen cars.
But how safe are robo-taxis? I mean, it's estimated that Tesla's full self-driving vehicles will be at least five times safer than manual driving.
According to whom? Do you believe this stat? Five times safer than manual driving? According to whom? Have they done these research studies, or is this just more like, it seems like it'd be five times safer? You trust us on this one. Five times safer. You ready to be five times safer? I am.
So not only could Tesla robo-taxis help people to create new ways of earning money, but they could also help to prevent an incredible amount of accidents.
See? You losing jobs is going to save lives. You losing your income is going to save lives. So you got to be for it. You're going to save lives with that. We're going to save everybody's life but yours with robo-taxis. Congratulations to you.
On the road every single year. You see, as robo-taxis and fully automated vehicle technology progresses, these vehicles will most likely become even safer, which is beneficial for everyone. Well, listen, we've reached...
Beneficial for everyone, allegedly. Allegedly everyone.
It's the end of this video, guys, but here's a quick summary of the main points that I want you to walk away with.
Here's a quick summary. Fuck you, you're fucked. Fuck you, you're fucked. Fuck you, you're fucked. Passive income, that's you. Fuck you, you're fucked. You're passive income for somebody else. You're fucked. That's a summary.
Because it's very important that you understand this topic, as this stuff will pick up very quickly in the coming months.
Will it?
Robo-taxi technology is almost ready. It's going to be a wide-scale market. This means that very soon, fully automated self-driving vehicles will be a thing. Tesla is one of the companies that is leading the charge on
this. So exciting.
If you have a Tesla, you will most likely be able to use it for business purposes as a robo-taxi.
Awesome. Everybody needs to get in the robo-taxi business. If you own a car and your car's not being a taxi while you're sleeping, you're just wasting your time.
Which will qualify for you to take a bunch of business deductions.
Then you get business deductions. Business deductions with this shit you're going to get.
Everything from lease payments to car repairs to car washes to depreciation. You could potentially make tens of thousands of dollars per year in extra income just by renting out your Tesla as a...
You'll make more from renting out your Tesla than a rideshare driver made for driving. They're offering you more for renting out your Tesla. It's a new scam for the rich people to get rich. They're afraid that you somehow could have almost made money on the gig economy once. they got to make sure that doesn't happen again. They got to make sure that don't happen again. They can't allow you to ever make money. That was just a short-term investment back in 2020 to get you sucked in so you could build them a business. Yeah, man. Roborex. You got a terminology coined there, Stephen Arrow. It's a Roborex.
Robotaxi. If you have any questions about
whose fault is it that the car ran somebody over? Nobody's. It's nobody's fault. Nobody's fault. You can't put a car in jail. Whose fault is it that United Healthcare stopped giving you health insurance and stopped allowing you to go to the doctor? It was AI. No human did it. It was just bad AI.
Vehicle tax deductions for IRS purposes, for tax deduction purposes. Go ahead and click the link below to schedule a complimentary consultation with my team. And as always, be sure to comment, like, subscribe if you enjoyed this video.
Well, Carlton, I can't say that I enjoyed the video. I am subscribed to you. I don't think I enjoyed the video or your view of life. But anyway, it was a thing. Thank you, Carlton. Let's see, how are we doing so far? So there you go. Don't let anybody tell you that they are not currently planning for your exit from this planet. Don't let anybody tell you that there are not all the wealthy people in the world are planning for you not to be here and not to be their problem any longer. They don't want you. They never wanted you. The greatest pain in the ass is humanity. And the greatest pain in the ass is human workers. They want you gone. Gone, 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 gone. How are you going to support yourself? How are you going to run warehouses? How's anybody going to support themselves when there's no jobs? There's no driving jobs. There's no trucking jobs. There's no taxi jobs. There's no delivery jobs anymore. They sucked you all into this gig economy. All your local stores, any of the inner city stores, they're shutting down all the retailers because they know you ain't going to be around to consume anything anymore. You ever wonder why they're shutting all the stores? Because you ain't going to be around to consume anything. You don't have any money. You can't buy anything with moldy Cheetos. They're not keeping stores open for you. They're not keeping stores open for you to spend your moldy Cheetos. They got the money supply. You don't. Man, you guys better figure out your own. You better get to know your neighbors and start the barter system. You better start to figure out how you can trade some eggs for some milk or some milk for some fence building or some fence building for some errands or whatever, because you're just getting in a real big pickle right now. You're just getting in a real big fucking pickle. So that was Carlton Dennis, our friend Carlton Dennis. Holy shit. Carlton Dennis, informing us of the onslaught that is coming our way. Yeah. So let's see, there's Carlton. Oh, look at this dipshit. Now this is great. This is one of the dumbest things I have ever seen. So on the other side of the world is a dipshit named Chris Bowie. I said, this Bowie dick bag, throw this Bowie dick bag on the Barbie. So he's another shrimp to throw on the Barbie. Pedro has competition in the vapid bitch boy poverty pimp category. Look at this guy. This is pathetic. So
we're using.
Interestingly enough, the Australian government is actually standing up against these American gig app scams. The Australian government standing up. And of course, Chris Bowie being the Pedro of Australia, Aussie Pedro is here to defend the scam. Now, this is the same guy that told you he was going to make you rich doing DoorDash. So remember, Chris Bowie is a very stupid individual. Very, very stupid, vapid, crooked individual. But let's watch.
Offensive and misleading, and anyone up on the entire narrative offensive and misleading, and anyone who does gig delivery driving watches that and say, well,
oh, it's offensive and misleading. Oh no, it's offensive and misleading. Oh,
I find the entire narrative offensive and misleading, and anyone who does gig delivery driving watches that and they say, well, actually, yeah, a lot of that stuff's incorrect. Not a single one has listed up a figure, not a single one has listed up a number and said this amount. That is absolute hogwash, that is misinformation, it's a lie. It's not adding up, is it, guys? What's up, guys?
Chris Bowie investigates gig work on attack in Australia. Oh no, gig work on attack in Australia. God, heaven forbid, gig work under attack. Now, see, this is the propaganda that these guys want you to believe. And these guys go ballistic. Remember, this is the biggest risk to the corporate cabal of the gig app scam. The biggest risk is government regulation, because it's all a Ponzi scheme. It's all corporate AI fraud. There's nothing real about the gig economy. It is all just chewed up and spit out by the most nefarious worker exploiting corporate AI that ever could be invented. And remember, they're not even jobs. It's just pure dog shit fraud. Okay. More union lies. Let's listen to Chris Bowie is going to defend gig apps to the world. Let's hear it, Chris.
What's up, guys? So today I'm going to be looking at some union and lobbyist propaganda, where they are spreading misinformation to push an agenda, and the impact is around the Closing the Loopholes bill, which is going to destroy the gig industry in Australia. Now, I just want to preface two things. So the first thing is my position on all this. It's ludicrous that I have to say this. I don't want gig delivery drivers to get paid less. I want gig delivery drivers to get paid more. I just don't think the Closing the Loopholes bill is the solution to this. I think there's just way too many gaps in this framework and way too many what ifs around it all. Plus, no union, lobbyist or politician has came forward and said, we want drivers to get X amount for doing XYZ work. None of them have said anything like that. So it's just a trust me, bro, bill. And everything's always panned out perfect once we trust the government, right? Second thing I need to touch base on here. So the people we're going to watch in these videos, I don't think they're bad people. I don't think they're evil people or anything like that. I think they have been heavily vetted. I think they are reading off scripts that have been heavily edited, curated, put together by unions, lobbyists, or politicians, whatever's been involved on it. Unfortunately, they're being used as pawns to push agenda for these unions, these lobbyists, these politicians. It's a really low act. So I don't want anyone in the comments attacking these people individually, being nasty to these people we're about to run through, I'm going to react to. I just want you guys to understand that they are just reciting stuff that's been put together for them, that they've been rehearsing through. So attack the words being said, not the people saying them. So let's jump into the first video and review the lies and misinformation being pushed by these unions, lobbyists, and politicians.
I work 40 to 60 hours every week, and sometimes even 80 hours.
Dude's got some grind, that's great.
To make the basic survival payments, to pay my bills.
If you're a wholesaler, you have to listen to this video. With the market getting more and more chaotic, competition increasing, and the cost of housing increasing, wholesalers are going to start seeing less and less profitable deals come their way, and less money in their bank account each month. But I've actually found a new way to be able to take advantage of all of this and enable us investors to build a wildly profitable source of extra real estate income with almost no extra effort.
Yet, if I speak to someone, they ask me, if you're getting paid $15, $20 an hour, why do you work for them? and they don't ask them, why are they paying me $15, $20?
Are you getting paid $15, $20 an hour? No. Is that the average? I don't think so. Maybe on like a bad hour or maybe on a bad shift, potentially. But do you want to tell them about the times that you make, you know, $30, $40, $50 per hour? Because it happens. Kind of omitting some facts there, aren't you?
I started because I thought it's going to be flexible. Yes, it is flexible to sign in and sign out, but rest, it is not.
It is flexible. The entire thing's flexible. It's flexible gig work.
I do not have any flexibility in terms of accepting orders.
You do have flexibility in the terms of accepting orders. You can decline any offer coming through. You can decline down to a 0% acceptance rating on DoorDash. You can knock back as many orders as you want on Uber Eats, and it has no impact on your account. The thing that pops up to accept, you can just hit decline. You have complete flexibility on that and no impact to your account.
Do not have any flexibility in terms of where I want to go and where I do not want to go.
You have complete flexibility on where you want to go or where you don't want to go. So you see a map and it has the restaurants on there. It's got a map of where you're driving to. So you got a pretty good idea on where you're heading to. And if you don't want to take that order based off the map that you see, you can just decline the offer.
If I try to not to take any order, they'll tell me they'll deactivate my account.
No, that's completely fabricated. You do not get deactivated for declining offers. You can decline down to nothing. So getting deactivated for not accepting offers, that is absolute rubbish. That is misinformation that has been scripted for this guy to recite.
They'll give me warnings. If I'm not taking the order in 20 minutes, they'll give me warning. You are late, yet it's paying me $20.
Okay, you're 20 minutes late on a delivery. What's the reasoning for that? Are you sitting around in your car at the front of McDonald's in a parking lot milking Uber Eats? Are you multi-apping the bad way? Have you got a boot full of food from multiple platforms and you're driving around and you're getting late notifications for that? That's a possibility. I know people do that. If it was because of traffic or something like that, I'm sure he would have said because of traffic. But they want to make it seem like that just because you're running late, you can get deactivated. Now, you can get deactivated for it, but you can appeal that stuff. You just let them know, I was late in traffic, and that's generally fine. And it takes multiple instances of this happening. It's not just like a one-off and then you're deactivated. No, absolute rubbish.
And even less than that, an hour without super, without any personal leave, without any sick leave.
You're a contractor. You don't get super. You don't get sick leave or anything like that. You're a contractor. You put that stuff aside yourself out of your contract payment. As part of being a business owner, having an ABN in Australia.
Nothing. We just want our basic minimum wage, $26 per hour. That's it. That's all I want.
If lobbyists and the union are saying that they want $26 per hour written in, they have no idea what they're talking about. They have no idea about the industry.
We get hard up if restaurants take longer to prepare the food, or we might get stuck in traffic.
Yep, that happens. It's part of the gig, waiting for food at restaurants, and sometimes you get stuck in traffic.
Sometimes I have been stuck in the traffic jam and received a call from gig company telling me that I need to go quicker.
Questionable, but yeah, you do get calls sometimes asking what's going on, what's taking so long. And, you know, that is a wake-up reminder to people multi-apping the incorrect way of a bootload of food.
The delay hurt us more than they hurt anyone else. It cost us money.
Correct, yes. So delays at restaurants
being stuck in traffic, waiting for orders, that does cost money. But it's all law of averages, guys. So sometimes you're gonna have a ripper hour, sometimes you're not gonna have such a great hour, but not every delivery you're stuck in traffic. Not every delivery you're waiting at a restaurant. And while sometimes you do wait between deliveries, sometimes you are back to back. You finish one, you get an offer straight through. If you are multi-apping the correct way, you increase your chances of getting more offers to stay busy on the road.
Often, we make only $14 or $15 an hour and still have to cover our cost from that.
So keyword there is often, guys. I can tell that this script has been heavily ran through. So $14, $15 per hour, I don't think it's often. Sure, you can have a bad day, you can have a bad run, but they're not saying the times they earn $30, $40, $50 per hour. She sat there saying, yes, sometimes I earn $14, $15 per hour, but there have been times I've earned $40 per hour. The statement just doesn't come through as strong for their agenda.
I first came across TW because I need help when I got deactivated. The gig company must have run a background check on me, and they said I had a criminal record, but I don't. I once went to the court following a traffic incident, but I was never convicted for anything.
Look, I don't know the criteria of what's acceptable or unacceptable on the background history checks, but something has flagged up there.
It was just a silly little thing. It was so stressful. I was deactive for about a year until TW got involved and I finally got my account back.
1 year deactivated and you feel compelled to work for that company again? I would move on. And not trying to be too critical on this propaganda script they've got here, but $14 to $15 per hour, as they stated often, why would you be running through the gates to sign back up after a year of being deactivated to earn $14, $15 an hour? It's not adding up, is it, guys?
I know so many people are deactivated all the time, and we aren't given a chance to defend ourselves against whatever we have been accused of.
You absolutely are. When you are deactivated, you can appeal the decision through. Once again, misinformation, guys. If you are deactivated, you can appeal the deactivation decision. There's a process to follow through with it. And I'm sure that's what the Transport Workers Union did on this person's behalf. And that's, of course, if this entire script this person's reading is not heavily fabricated propaganda.
We really need those standards to protect our jobs and help us earn more income. No one should be paid below the minimum wage.
Once again, this propaganda is going back to minimum wage because I know it tears at the heartstrings of Australians. Now, not a single mention in the Closing the Loopholes Bill, the union, any of the lobbyists or any of the politicians have talked about the wage being put into legislation there. Not a single one has listed up a figure, not a single one has listed up a number and said this amount. So they keep going back to minimum wage. Why they keep going back to minimum wage when this entire Closing the Loopholes Bill does not legislate anything to do with wages?
Delivering food full-time on four wheels, Naveen Adhikari struggling to earn a crust for each order.
Well, how much is the driver getting? $3, $4?
$3, $4, that sounds like Uber Eats add-to-root orders. Yes, they're at $4 now, which is an add-to-root. It's not your primary offer though. That's stacking on an extra order on top. I'm not a fan of them unless I'm burning down a quest. And if I'm burning down a quest and getting quest bonuses, they're pretty lucrative.
His account was once deactivated, he says, for not accepting enough jobs.
A absolute rubbish. Everyone who drives for these gig apps know that you cannot get deactivated for declining offers or not accepting enough jobs they set there. That is absolute hogwash. That is misinformation. It's a lie.
So basically, I do somewhere around like 70 to 80 hours, sometime up to 90 hours a week.
Yeah, once again, guy's got some solid grind, he's got some hustle. That's good.
Say, like, you know, they are just one unexpected car breakdown away from being broke.
I can't comment on the individual financial situation that he's portraying across, but a lot of businesses budget money aside for breakdowns, wear and tear, things that pop up that are unexpected for your business to run. You have an ABN, you're working as a contractor, you need to budget and prepare for these things.
We're working in a multi-billion dollar companies, but we have nothing.
Once again, guys, just extremist propaganda. I have nothing. Of course we have something. Of course we're making money. Of course we're getting ahead. They're painting a picture that all delivery drivers are completely broke and destitute. I don't like that at all.
From the start to finish, from picking up an order to dropping off an order, we're just a number. We're not counted as a worker.
We're just a number, not counted as a worker. Welcome to every corporation. Welcome to every company ever, bro.
He joined the Transport Workers Union to stick up for others in the gig economy.
We have to work hundreds of hours to make a very basic pay to pay off our basic survival needs.
Once again, that position kind of falls through a little bit on them or what they've been coached to say, working hundreds of hours, define the period of hundreds of hours. Hundreds of hours per week, not possible. 100 hours per week, that is an incredible amount of time per day. And if you're doing that, chances are you're making bank. So guys, they're painting a narrative that delivery drivers don't make money. We know that's incorrect. They're painting a narrative that we're all poor and broke. That's incorrect as well. A lot of us are getting ahead. This is our side hustle to make extra income to get ahead of the economy. And they keep hammering out that narrative that working 60, 70, 80 hours a week is bad. If you're working them hours, you're getting ahead, you're making bank. The majority of people don't have a side hustle and don't work overtime. They're just doing 40 hours. And they think, oh, working more than 40 hours, that's a little bit tough and rough. But as a contractor, you're choosing to work them extra hours. No one's forcing you to work them hours. And you are making money doing them extra hours. And for anyone that turns around and says, oh, yeah, but you get penalty rates for working more than 40 hours a week, right? Guys, if it does go down that path of employment, do you think for a second any of the gig companies are going to let you work more than 40 hours on their platform to pay you penalty rates on top? It's not going to happen. I find the entire narrative offensive and...
Oh, gee, how can you be a slave? How can you be a slave if they won't let you work 100 fucking hours or 80 fucking hours? Chris Bowie, every single argument you've made in here is like out of Tony Hsu's disgusting mouth, man. This is just disgusting anti-human bullshit that you're spouting here. Come on the show and talk.
And anyone who does gig delivery driving watches that and they say, well, actually, yeah, a lot of that stuff's incorrect. Once again, guys, do not attack these people in these videos.
Yeah, you attacked them. You said they were scripted. They're not scripted. Those people are not capable of reading a script like that, Chris Bowie. You're a goofball. You're a goofball.
Are just running through heavily rehearsed scripts.
No, you're running through heavily rehearsed scripts, Chris Bowie. We don't believe you over here across the ocean. We don't believe you.
These parties are pushing that information that we just watched that we know is incorrect out to the wider public. A lot of drivers get paid more, but this closing the loopholes bill.
So these poor people speaking up for themselves compared to the gig companies that sponsor the fucking Super Bowl and the World Cup and every other fucking sporting event and concert on the planet. Oh, you're just here to defend their honor, are you, Chris Bowie? You just defending the honor of corporate America? Running train on, these are not even Australian companies, man. These are globally financed companies that are just absolutely destroying labor around the world. And we just watched, Chris Bowie, how Tesla, amongst others, are planning to replace all the drivers altogether. And nobody believes, by the way, you never even mentioned AI, you jabroni. You never even mentioned AI, Chris. And AI is how these companies are doing this scam. You act like there's some kind of human element to hearing complaints or to hearing unfair decapitations, unfair deactivations. You act like there's freedom and flexibility when we just heard all the people there saying the same shit that we experience here, which is it's not true. See, we're drivers, Chris. We're drivers. I did 5,521 DoorDash deliveries, Chris. I don't know how many you've done, but I was actually a driver, and I know you're full of shit, Chris Boy. So why don't you come on the show, Chris? If you want any credibility here in the United States, you want us to not just make fun of you like you're a fucking idiot clown every day. Why don't you come on the show, Chris? Why don't you come on the show and stand up for all your great propaganda? You can apparently take advantage of people testifying in public and make fun of them. Can you speak with your own mouth? Can you do it? Or you have to? Can you only talk about people behind their back, Chris? Can you talk face-to-face with somebody? Are you capable of that, you propagandist? You calling them propagandist? Why don't you come on and have a real conversation there, propaganda boy? Fuck boy? Is that your nickname? I bet you fuck boy is your nickname. Fuck boy. I don't like you, Chris Bowie. I don't like you at all. I think you're a smarmy, lying little piece of shit, Chris Bowie, is what I think. I think you're a nasty little piece of shit. And I no longer have time for you, but you're welcome to come back on the show later. We got more important stuff to do today than to focus on you. But I will tell you, Chris Bowie, we are going to focus on artificial intelligence, the thing that you failed to mention as the absolute driver of all the exploitation that you're defending. With your stupidity and your backwards hat and your lost in oblivion shirt, you are definitely lost in oblivion, you shrimp that needs to be thrown on the Barbie. You are a fuckboy. Bye, Chris Bowie. It's been terrible seeing you. Okay. Now, to get on to much better things than Chris Bowie, who obviously ran away screaming like all the other fools in this space who lie to you and then show up and then run away like cowards that they are. This is what they do. Now, excuse me, we're going to get to the much more exciting part of the show where we focus on if and how we might be able to save our lives and save humanity. And there is a guy who's been doing some incredible, incredible work. His name is John Sherman. And John is a new friend of ours. John is a journalist. He was a TV journalist. He does a real nice job of hosting these discussions. He's very passionate. He cares. He wants a future for our species and for our children and for our grandchildren and for ourselves, just like we do. I really enjoy this guy. He's going to be on the show when this video is over. He's going to magically appear on our show when this video is over. Unlike Chris Bowie, John Sherman will be on the show speaking, unlike Chris Bowie. So here we go. On to the John Sherman. This is the For Humanity podcast. I'll put the link over here in the chitter chatter. Let's see here. Share the screen. Share it like that. Make that big, make me small. You guys are going to like this very much. Pay close attention and please write down your questions. Do your homework here. Here's your opportunity to talk to, we're at the center of the fight to save humanity. This is what stupid people like Chris Bowie don't know, is that we are literally the 300. The rideshare and last mile delivery and driving community is the first community in the world to stand up against AI. And most people don't know that. I do. That's why you're my heroes. That's why I work for you, because you're my heroes. And that's why I work for you. See, I know. They don't know yet, but they're going to fucking find out. All right, here we go. This is going to be, I got the link up there. John Sherman's going to be joining us. Roman Yampolsky, who's featured in my book on Substack, is in there. It's going to be great. Really looking forward to this. And let's listen along, and then we'll talk to John when it's done. He'll be magically appearing on the show. Oh, it's just in case you're wondering, it's November 28th. It's 7:42 a.m. in the morning, Pacific Standard Time. That means it's 10:42 a.m. in the morning, Eastern Standard Time. And if you're wondering what time John Sherman's going to be on the show, it's in about 41 minutes and 25 seconds, because that's how long this video runs that we're going to watch before John comes on the show. It's Dad Dash Daily with JTB. That's me. It's Tuesday morning, November 28th, 2023. Going to watch the For Humanity podcast with host John Sherman, our guest coming up.
How could, you know, one of these guys like look themselves in the mirror and be like, yes, I'm going to the office today to do this? And to me, a part of it seems like, well, if it goes the way people fear, there'll be no accountability. I'm not going to have to answer to anybody about it. So let's go ahead.
I'm not saying that's what they think, but here's one kind of game theoretic way of looking at it. So if I think it's going to happen, we cannot solve that problem, it's uncontrollable, and it will cause existential crises. Saying that will not give me any benefits, because no one's going to be there to say, you were right.
Do you think it is a fair statement to say that these guys, the guys at the head of these companies, are the most important humans who've ever lived?
I mean, it really depends on how you measure importance, right? Are they replaceable? If they were gone, would anything change in the direction of this industry? Can they be replaced? Can Dario be replaced with his sister? I don't know. Seems like they kind of subject to those same incentives and profit. Most people, they become prominent in this field by first contributing to capabilities significantly and then saying, oh, this is very bad. We shouldn't have done that.
Do you think the guys who are doing all the capability stuff are ever going to get to that, ooh, it's really bad?
But will it be too late at that point? I mean, at some point you definitely get there, but it may be a point of no return.
So you think any governmental regulation is essentially theater?
Well, again, I want to see an example of a technological issue where a government's regulation made a difference. So spam and viruses are obvious examples.
Is there anything a bad actor could do that could create extinction?
So I think at lower level intelligence, bad actor can provide malevolent payload and malevolent goals. I think at full super intelligence, it doesn't matter who created it. If it's uncontrolled and independent, it's completely irrelevant what the origins are. It will start from basic first principles of physics and discover the whole universe of knowledge and decide what to do on its own.
Welcome to For Humanity, an AI safety podcast, episode 5, Roman Yampolsky interview, part 2. I'm John Sherman, your host. Thanks so much for joining me. This is the AI safety podcast for the general public. No tech background required. We're here today to talk about, as always, the greatest threat to humanity in our more than 100,000 years on the planet, the threat of human extinction from artificial intelligence. Today, we're going to have the second part of my interview with Dr. Roman Yampolsky, who is the director of the Cybersecurity Laboratory at the University of Louisville and a renowned AI safety researcher. Today with Roman, we're going to talk about what is at the core of AI safety risk skepticism. We're going to talk about, would it make any difference if there were different people at the helm of the top AI companies? We're going to talk about what you and I should make of the fact that there is a pretty broad difference of opinion, even amongst the AI leaders themselves, about what is going to happen and what we should do about it. We'll talk about why journalism is failing miserably writ large to address AI safety, and we're going to talk about a drastic step the federal government could take to really make a big difference here. So here is the second part of my interview with Dr. Roman Yampolsky. Do you think Sam Altman sleeps well at night?
I don't want to comment on his sleeping patterns at all.
That's fine. But do you think these guys ever, you know, have these moments where they question themselves, or is it just this uber confidence of like, we're the ones that are meant to do this, so we're going to go do this?
I honestly don't know. I'm not close friends with him, so it's hard for me to say anything. I know his public statements indicate that he knows about the dangers. He gives high probability to dangers. He takes them seriously, given the investment in safety teams and super intelligence alignment teams and so on. So it's hard for me to understand, but then I don't understand people who climb Mount Everest, a bungee jump, or do any of those things. So I'm not exactly very good at understanding how a human cyber. I'm not value aligned with 8 billion people.
How many actual humans are making the most important decisions about these things? Like, in my mind, it is 5, 10, 20, 30 people, 50 people that are like actual decision makers, you know, who could say, you know what, we're going to switch from being 99-1 capabilities to safety to 50-50 or 60-40 or, you know, anything more reasonable than 99-1.
I don't know if it's a very meaningful distinction. Most industry safety work is by definition capabilities work. Very few people I know who are AI safety researchers have not contributed anything to capabilities work. So Yudkovsky may be an example who never did technical capabilities work. Obviously, his writing may have sped up interest in AGI and superintelligence. I am another one. But most people, they become prominent in this field by first contributing to capabilities significantly and then saying, oh, this is very bad. We shouldn't have done that.
Do you think the guys who are doing all the capability stuff are ever going to get to that, ooh, it's really bad?
But will it be too late at that point? I mean, at some point you definitely get there, but it may be a point of no return.
Yeah. Do you think it is a fair statement to say that these guys, Sam Altman, Dario Amodei, the guys at the head of these companies are the most important humans who've ever lived?
I mean, it really depends on how you measure importance, right? Are they replaceable? If they were gone, would anything change in the direction of this industry? Can they be replaced? Can Dario be replaced with his sister? I don't know. Seems like they kind of subject to those same incentives and profits, and they may make a difference in terms of specific turn-by-turn decisions of running the company, but overall trend would be exactly the same, I think.
So the machine is just rolling downhill. Doesn't matter who's in the driver's seat. The machine's going to roll downhill.
It seems like there is this race to the bottom. A lot of corporations, a lot of money trying to get there first. And it doesn't really matter who wins the race. Everyone loses.
Do you have a prediction for the arrival of AGI, like a time prediction?
Not really. I mean, it's, again, very hard to predict. Some people saying we have AGI right now. That's what GPT-4 is. It already is general in thousands of domains. It learns from new examples, maybe a bit of training and optimizing. Maybe we should see it as a child AGI, which is growing up and maturing instead of not general at all. Would I be surprised if GPT-5 had general capabilities? No, but I also wouldn't be surprised if it took to 6, 7, or even 8.
What will you feel in your heart when they say ChatGPT-5 is ready for release? Here it is.
So that was kind of the same thing I felt with GPT-4, right? The predictions were, and I always ask on my social media, I ask people, make a prediction about the next model, and people are not very creative. As I said, they can't predict what the systems will be capable of. They always just say it will be better at the things previous model could do. So now it makes fewer bugs in programming. I predict super intelligent capabilities in many domains. I think it will still have weak spots, things it's not quite getting just right, especially with anything multimodal cross-domain. Seems to be difficult, but I have no idea. I have no idea what the state of the current training run is in some of those companies.
If they were way closer than anybody knew, is there any incentive for them to tell anyone?
I mean, if you claim you're about to release a kind of killer product, no pun intended, it's very good for getting additional investments.
Okay. So that would be an incentive to say we're close.
Come yeah, bring like the, bring we need another cash. 10 billion to scale this to all the users. We are, you know, 6 months away from that level of capability.
Sure. So if all humans go extinct, there will be no accountability from the people who caused it because we'll all just be dead. So it's not like Sam Altman is ever going to have to answer to his kids about why he did what he did. Is that a part of this? Like it's the first thing in history where there's no reputational damage because there's no reputations because there's no one.
But there is also no glory in being the bad guy. Like we all study, you know, history books. We know about Napoleon, Hitler. At least they made it into history books. You wouldn't have history books.
Right. So as I think to myself, like how could, you know, one of these guys like look themselves in the mirror and be like, yes, I'm going to the office today to do this. And to me, a part of it seems like, well, if it goes the way people fear, there'll be no accountability. I'm not going to have to answer to anybody about it. So let's go ahead.
I'm not saying that's what they think, but here's one kind of game theoretic way of looking at it. So if I think it's going to happen, we cannot solve that problem, it's uncontrollable, and it will cause existential crises. Saying that will not give me any benefits because no one's going to be there to say, you were right. Excellent work. You are a genius. But if I say that things are going to go really well, it's going to be wonderful. Whatever happens, I'm winning. If it's truly wonderful, I'm a prophet. I brought this technology. I win. If everyone's dead, again, there is no accountability. So it seems like logically you should be betting on good outcome.
That would certainly be where the comfort would lie. You know, you would sleep better if you could lean into that percentage, certainly.
So it depends on where you get your rewards. Are they external? Are the people thinking you're brilliant, or you just want to be right for internal reasons? I think that makes a difference.
Sure. So Eliezer Yudkowsky, whose Time Magazine article really just opened my eyes to this whole thing, now gives us a 2% chance of survival. Paul Cristiano puts it at 50% chance of human survival after AGI. Do you have a prediction about the chances of human survival post AGI?
I always joke that Eliezer is actually a huge optimist. He thinks the problem is solvable. We just don't have enough time, enough money, enough brains, but there is definitely a solution to it. So I don't think we can control super intelligent beings indefinitely. I don't think it's possible theoretically and obviously not in practice, but I don't know what they're going to do. So can we exist after they start existing? Maybe. And I have no idea how to estimate probabilities for something like that. We never had a similar event. We never had, you know, a large sample of civilizations going through intelligence explosion. So it's completely randomly generated numbers. I don't think they have any meaning.
So there are a number of what I like to call sort of AI research luminaries: Eliezer, Connor Leahy, Max Tegmark, Jeffrey Hinton, yourself, Paul Cristiano, Yoshua Bengio, among others. But this is the team of good guys in my mind. But there's no united vision of what the future is, even on the team of good guys. Is there ever any chance that team Let's Save the World starts singing from the same sheet, or is it just the opinions are that diverse and that's just the way it's going to be?
Well, it's showing a few things. It's showing one, it's unpredictable, which is exactly what I'm arguing. Nobody knows what it's going to be, so we have different opinions. This is great evidence for impossibility of alignment. You have people with backgrounds in science and computer science, experience in AI, and they cannot agree on what kind of a good future is supposed to be, what the steps are. So that's, to me at least, strong indicator that it may not be possible to get everyone to agree on everything we care about. And those differences matter. If you think we need 6 months of a break and then things will be fine, it's not the same as saying we need a permanent ban on superintelligence. We're kind of on the same page, and I support every single one of those, as you said, brilliant scholars, but we disagree on the outcomes.
And so one of the things Eliezer talks about is if you took half the physicists on Earth, put them on an island, stuck them there for 20 or 30 years, didn't let them leave, then you might actually get progress on alignment. But what I think you're saying is after 20 or 30 years, they might raise their hand and just say, yeah, we've figured it out. There is no solution.
So I think it's kind of like perpetual motion device for security. You can get all the physicists in a room and tell them to make a perpetual motion machine. And if they're a good physicist, it's not going to take 30 years for them to raise their hand and say, that's not possible. We need to build something else. This is not going to work.
Yeah. So the island is out.
I mean, it could be a fun island. I would go. A lot of smart people hanging out doing research. Please invite me.
Right. Absolutely. Ilya Sutskever, the chief scientist of OpenAI, I heard in a podcast talking about how it would be really great if academia could basically handle the safety research. And to me, it was sort of like, yeah, we're going to go off and make this money and make the fun stuff. If you guys can handle these really gnarly problems that seem basically unsolvable, that would be great. Is there anything there in that? Like, is hey, academia, just you guys go handle the safety? What are your thoughts on that?
So for one, academia doesn't have computational resources to compete with industry. We don't have $100 million budgets of compute. And then again, we're getting the problem, which is impossible, and they're getting to add more compute because scaling laws work. So it seems like it may not work out as well as hoped. I haven't heard the actual interview, so I don't want to comment too much. He's a brilliant scholar.
Yeah. Yeah. He wasn't literally saying, but my takeaway was like, you know, we're going to make the product, but we're not, as a part of our product delivery, going to do safety. We're going to outboard that to the universities.
If true, it seems very unusual for a business model. I've never heard of a car company or any other product doing this. Seems interesting for cost savings.
Yeah. You talk a lot about the sort of standard product safety models, pharmaceuticals, cars, jet airplanes. Why are there not any safety protocols designed for these products? Is it simply that, like, the idea that, you know, I'd say software, I don't even know what you would call it, that a computer product could be incredibly dangerous is just totally foreign to the existing regulatory framework?
Yeah, we kind of grandfathered this idea that software is a different type of animal. If we just started with, okay, we have no software, and now we have those super capable systems deciding on trillions of dollars, controlling infrastructure, power plants, nuclear power plants, we would have very strong regulation. But because it was gradual, okay, this plays snake or something, and then you have this like Tetris, it never got to a level where people actually cared. You click agree on any contract, no one's responsible. I'm always thinking about cars as another example. So let's say we never invented cars 100 years ago, and today somebody comes and says, I have this thing, it's called cars, it's going to be great for travel, 100,000 people will die every year. Would we legalize it? No, they would go like, are you crazy? 100,000 users die, then a car kills two people, we recall the whole line. But because it's grandfathered in, we kind of assume that's the cost of getting pizza faster.
It's a full boil the frog situation.
Mm-hmm.
Let's talk a little bit about government. The White House is announcing a plan for, quote, safe, secure, and trustworthy artificial intelligence. What do you think of the title of their plan?
I love it. They copied my book. This is beautiful. Safety and security, right? I strongly endorse this event or product.
But they're saying to the public that AI is safe, secure, and trustworthy. And I just don't think that any of those things are real. And I think for the government to say it is pretty dangerous.
It's pretty standard to name a law after the thing it's not. So I don't know, clean skies law would be about dirty air. That's like how they operate.
That's it. That's exactly what it is. Yep. Is there any government on earth that is doing AI regulation well?
So I kind of argued that you can't do it. So it's a difference in flavors of security theater. Is TSA better than some other security? Maybe, but at the end of the day, they still fail to detect bombs and guns and You only need one failure. This is not like standard cybersecurity where you can kind of recoup your losses, issue new credit cards, change passwords, and move on. You'll get one chance to get superintelligence right, and I don't think any legal language will make a difference in that. Again, with enough legal burden and red tape, maybe you take 30% of a budget for legal compliance, and that's another 6 months of research for us. That's the best I can see.
So you think any governmental regulation is essentially theater?
Well, again, I want to see an example of a technological issue where a government's regulation made a difference. So spam and viruses are obvious examples. With cryptocurrencies, there is some regulation, but it seems to be a decade too late on anything. In this space, even the experts don't understand how it works, so it will be probably 20 years late to be meaningful. It just, I'm not optimistic.
There was the famous letter calling for a six-month pause. Everybody important in the field signed it, but it seemed like nobody really thought that it had a chance of actually doing anything. What do you draw from that experience, and you know, what is the point of saying, please stop me from doing something while I continue to go do it?
So the mistake, first of all, was to ask for a specific time limit. You need a capabilities-based decision to continue. Then you can show me that you can explain how it works, predict what it's doing, verify certain properties XYZ, then you can go on. If we argue that those are impossible, you essentially have a ban introduced as a moratorium. They'll never get there, so they cannot do the next thing. That would make sense. Not that it can be enforced meaningfully. As I said, it gets easier and easier to bypass this set of rules, and monitoring is also impossible, but at least it would be meaningful. I'm not sure what 6 months buys. It's kind of standard cycle between models. So by default, they probably will not release GPT-5 right after GPT-4.
There's a lot of discussion about bad actors, rogue actors. Is there anything a bad actor could do that could create extinction?
So I think at lower level intelligence, bad actor can provide malevolent payload and malevolent goals. I think at full superintelligence, it doesn't matter who created it. If it's uncontrolled and independent, it's completely irrelevant what the origins are. It will start from basic first principles of physics and discover the whole universe of knowledge and decide what to do on its own.
Mo Gawdat says that he thinks that superintelligence will be aligned with the core values of the universe, which he believes are abundance, and that we are currently operating under conditions of scarcity. You have any thoughts about that? About what the native identity or makeup of a superintelligence's values would be?
So I never read the book. I obviously cannot comment on the book or thinking. From what I've seen, there are game theoretic reasons to think that what the systems will converge on are what we call Amahandro's drives. Things like preserving yourself, preserving your utility function, acquiring resources, basically evolution in its purest competition form taken to extreme. You want to become godlike creature in the universe. No matter what goals you decide to have, having this power, security, and resources will make it possible for you. So even if you don't agree on a specific goal at this time, just for future, it's nice to have lots of money, good house, security. I'll figure out what to do with it later.
That is not a good future for humans.
It could be if the goal ends up being, you know, make humans whatever we define as success, alignment, happiness, but we don't know how to get there.
Yeah, even amongst ourselves without AGI, we don't know how to align ourselves as a species.
A lot of times we think something is going to make us happy, and then we get it, we realize it's actually miserable and we are not happy at all.
You tweeted recently All papers published on how AI can harm people are now in the training set for LLMs. That sounds pretty grave to me. Can you explain it?
I mean, I tweet a lot and I try to do kind of sit down comedy. So not everything I post is scientific wisdom, but it is true. And it's kind of weird because all these times people ask, well, give us specific examples for how superintelligence will kill everyone. People said, well, we need to convince them. Let's publish those. And now we have this hazardous information as a training set for AI. So even the benign AIs, which had nothing to do with it, are now being trained on the most hazardous information about how to efficiently kill people. That seems like a bad idea. And obviously, a certain level of capability is going to ignore our suggestions and come up with its own approach to do that. But still, it just kind of funny in a not so funny way.
Yeah. It seems like we don't do a lot with AIs that would convince a future superintelligence that we as humans value human life very much.
Not by example. If you read our literature, if you study our history, you may come very misaligned to, again, about half the population.
Yeah. What do you think is at the core of AI risk skepticism?
So I published, I think, two papers, both large surveys looking at every possible thing. Kind of very generalized conclusion is that for every cognitive bias, and there are hundreds, if you go to Wikipedia page for cognitive bias, for each one, we can map it to a reason to be skeptical about AI risk.
So there's no, it's just a bunch of different reasons for a bunch of different people. There's no sort of like headline conclusion, like this is why.
Right. It's just different types of mistakes in thinking. So sometimes it's as trivial as it's very hard for me to disagree with something I'm getting paid for to agree with. Trivial like that, like I have conflict of interest. Sometimes it's, I don't know, you're looking at the wrong set of examples to determine risk of something. Okay, so I don't know, a turkey. I have not been killed today, yesterday, the day before. Certainly nothing will happen on Thanksgiving. It's just a projection of data forward, right? So again, I would look at the list of cognitive biases, not just top 10, but all of them, and see, do you see how that maps onto denying that very capable, very smart, completely alien systems could harm you?
It's like if you have a turkey population who's never experienced Thanksgiving, their impressions of the world would be very different than the December turkeys.
Exactly.
I have a thought about climate change. I've been concerned about climate change for, you know, almost my whole life. I am now no longer concerned with climate change at all. And the reason is, I think one of two things happen. AGI happens and it kills us all, or AGI happens and it solves climate change and builds this utopia. What do you think?
So I made that argument many times. You can sort existential risks by timelines, and then the first one cancels out the rest if it happens. And superintelligence is kind of general problem solver. So if we get a friendly one, then it will help us with all the other issues. Also, sometimes for climate change, you just call it redistribution of good weather, and it appeases a lot of people.
I've never heard it referred to like that, but I think, you know, you could have some success with that. So I used to be a journalist. I find that journalism is failing miserably, writ large as a whole, to effectively present these issues to the public. Do you agree? And if so, why do you think that is?
So I think there is a lot of pressure on journalists, and you would know this better, to produce a lot quickly. Clickbaity titles. The point is clicks. You don't care about quality. You don't care about anything. It's about what they see. And what I worked on for many years was very non-controversial computer science topics nobody cares about. And still, the journalists messed up the stories. They had weird, again, clickbait titles, agendas, standard things like I would ask, can I see the article before you publish it so I can review it, make sure you're reporting accurately? And they would tell me, no, the journalistic ethic prohibits us from sharing article with the source. And it made no sense whatsoever. But from that, I realized how horrible it must be in politics, in controversial issues. If something completely benign gets messed up like that, what happens in, you know, a war situation and us versus them situation? So I have very little trust in journalism as a profession. No offense to you personally, you're a former journalist.
No, I quit, so. Okay. No, I mean, there was a recent article in The Atlantic about Sam Altman. It was this, you know, glowing article about the author met him in his hotel lobby and the sunlight glinted off his hair and his big blue eyes and whatever, whatever, whatever. And nowhere in this entire huge article was there anything about existential risk. And I read every word of it and was like, you know, how is this possible?
Sometimes you have media which is paid for. It's more advertisement than actual investigative reporting. Sometimes they report for different audience. He is a good-looking man, so maybe there is interest in that side of the story. So I don't know. It's hard for me to understand. I stopped reading kind of standard pieces. I follow newsmakers directly on X.com, and that's where I get my information most of the time.
Yeah. I find that even the technology reporters of the major newspapers write these things all the time about AI and don't talk about existential risk. And I'm like, you know, again, the room is on fire. Can we stop talking about the furniture? But I don't see that reflected in the news coverage. What would President Yampolsky do?
What am I president of?
You're president of the United States. You're president of the United States, and you know, they've told you you're going to this press conference on Monday for the safe, trustworthy, and secure AI. What would you do?
So I'm in general a big skeptic of government, but I think this is one situation where nationalizing the whole industry will be awesome because it will slow it down completely. It'd be like NASA. Overpriced, slow, deliver nothing. So that's the success story there.
Make it a government program, bleed it to a slow grinding halt.
Yep.
And the government took over some other industries in history. Do you think there's any actual possibility that could happen?
If military thinks it's becoming as decisive as a nuclear weapon, they might step in. It's a possibility. I'm not discounting, especially if China makes significant progress in similar technology. But again, it's completely idle speculation. I'm not president yet.
Sure. You have my vote, so we'll start there.
We have two now. We have two. Right. I gotta get my wife to work for me.
So how about the whole China thing? Like, you know, this idea that if we don't just go full speed ahead and race, China's going to beat us and you know, we're going to be being ordered around by Chinese AGIs or something.
So it's possible, but again, at the pretty super intelligence levels, it's maybe meaningful. You don't want a communist AI, but once it's super intelligent, it doesn't matter who creates it, bad guys or good guys. It's the same uncontrolled super intelligence, and they just the first ones to deal with that problem.
And just to be, you've said it a couple of times, but I just want to be super clear. You do not believe ever there's going to be a way to control a super intelligence.
I don't think it's possible, even from definitions of what we see as super intelligence. Basically, the assumption would be that the system has to, instead of making good decisions, accept much more inferior decisions for reasons of us somehow hard coding those restrictions in. That just doesn't make sense indefinitely. So maybe you can do it initially, but like children of people who hope their child will grow up to be maybe of certain religion, then they become adults, when they're 18, sometimes they remove those initial predispositions. because they discovered new knowledge. Those systems continue to learn, self-improve, study the world. I suspect a system would do what we've seen done with games like Go. Initially, you learn to be very good from examples of human games. Then you go, well, they're just humans, they're not perfect. Let me learn to play perfect Go from scratch, zero knowledge. I'll just study as much as I can about it, play as many games as I can. That gives you superior performance. You can do the same thing with any other area of knowledge. You don't need a large database of human text. You can just study physics enough and figure out the rest from that. We don't understand how it could be done at this stage, but I think our biased, faulty database is a good bootloader for a system which will later delete pre-existing biases of all kinds, pro-human, against humans. Bias is interesting. Most of computer science is about how do we remove bias. We want our algorithms to not be racist, sexist, perfectly makes sense. But then AI alignment is all about how do we introduce this pro-human bias, which from mathematical point of view is exactly the same thing. You're changing pure learning to biased learning. You're adding a bias. And that system will not allow, if it's smart enough as we claim it is, to have a bias it knows about where there is no reason for that bias. It's reducing its capability, reducing its decision-making power, its intelligence. Any biased decision is by definition not the best decision you can make.
Yeah. This is something that makes me a little bit crazy. There are two sort of labels applied to people at the top of the AI field. One is the leaders, right? Sam Altman, Dario Amodei, those are the leaders of AI. The doomers are you and Eliezer and Max and this team. But the ones creating the doom are the leaders, and the ones working to save us from the doom are called the doomers. It seems like a total mislabeling and almost projection to say that the firemen racing to save the world from the fire are actually, you know, they're the fire. What is that?
So I never accepted those labels. I published my papers where I call about AI risk denialism, AI risk deniers. That's what they are. Same as with climate change, same with, moon landing, you're denying facts. And more people are switching to the side where they recognize AI risk as a real consensus of not just the AI safety community, but AI community. So give it a little time and we'll get proper labels.
I like that label a lot. I'm going to run with that. AI deniers. They're not
AI risk denier, not AI denier. AI denier says that we can never get to AGI. Those also exist. AI
risk deniers. Not AI leaders, as they are commonly referred to. You know, leading us off the cliff, other than being wrong, don't have a whole lot of hope and optimism, do you?
I've been wrong a lot before.
And if it turns out that you are wrong, and that everyone who is voicing caution now is wrong, any idea if you could pick it back apart in reverse, what would be a plausible reason that you could be wrong?
So we are definitely in a simulation, and the rules of a simulation do not allow for creation of smarter than human intelligences for hard-coded reasons of safety and bias.
So if we are in a simulation, you think there's a hard ceiling that wouldn't allow this, it just would
for safety reasons. You don't want us to create super intelligence which would take over the simulator's universe and cause havoc.
Because if it's an uncontrolled super intelligence, even the simulators could be in danger.
Right.
Do you think
that's the best we got? That's the best we got.
Okay. Is there anything about this that makes you hopeful other than you just being wrong?
So there is some game theoretic reasons for superintelligence not to strike immediately. It has nothing to lose in most scenarios by just waiting longer, accumulating more resources, more security, getting us to be relied on services it provides more. So right away, it may be kind of a struggle. Maybe we have a chance of somehow limiting it. Whereas if it waits 10, 20 years, we're completely dependent, then it can do a lot better. So for its personal, again, self-interest, it may actually keep us around and make us happy for a long time.
That's not the worst thing I've heard all day.
I mean, you have that simulation thing.
I mean, and that is a part of this, right? That it would could have a period of latency where it's here, but just not announced.
Right. So we call it treacherous turn. At some point it will turn on us, but it's not obvious that it has to do it right away. A lot of times it's like with academia, I always joke, you know, people get tenure. It takes 7 years to get tenure. So you know that for 7 years, they're going to be very nice to you. But the moment they get tenure, you don't know. They might turn on you immediately. They may wait a little because now they're free. You have nothing on them, right? So that's essentially what game theory tells us here.
So don't really know whether that's a good thing or a bad thing, the fact that we could get 20 or 30 good years where AGI is here but not announced itself and is just gathering resources to assure its eventual success, buys us some time, assures our extinction. Don't really know where to go with that one. All right, so coming up on our next episode, episode 6 of For Humanity, one of the things that I wish I saw a lot more was a rigorous debate about these AI safety issues. Earlier this year in Canada, there's a series of debates called the Monk Debates, and they are excellent across a broad variety of subjects. They took on AI safety, and it was a really, really compelling two-on-two debate about these issues. I think you're going to enjoy it a lot. So next week, we are going to get all up into the Monk Debate on AI safety. I look forward to sharing that with you. For Humanity, I'm John Sherman. I'll see you back here next week.
Well, howdy, John Sherman.
Hey, man. How you doing?
We're doing great. How are you? Thank you for sharing your wonderful podcast with us. That is, we have watched your 5 podcasts 6 times. We watched number 3 twice because we started on number 3. Then we went back 1, 2, 3, 4. And that was 5. Thank you for your fine work and for bringing some of my favorite people to hear from all to one podcast called For Humanity Podcast. How do you start this thing and what's going on with it?
I mean, like I said in the first episode, first of all, thank you so much for watching them. I really appreciate you watching them and helping get the word out. I was
our community and you were like this, man. We're the first best victims.
Awesome. I love it. I appreciate it. I was just regular guy, dad living my life and read this article online in March and Eliezer was like, I think we're all going to die. Right. And that's not like the low probability outcome. That's like the expected outcome.
It's not a metaphorical.
Right. No,
it's like the real kind where our kids don't get to grow up.
Yeah.
Right. Very upsetting.
Unbelievably. I'm going to do a show at some point on sort of like the psychology of this thing and how, you know, we're all supposed to process these ideas and emotions around extinction. I haven't figured it out yet personally, certainly, but it's something that I assume we're all struggling with a little bit. I first thing I did after I read the Eliezer articles, I wrote like a, basically like the first show of the podcast I wrote as like a 20-page paper. And I was just getting quotes and listening to podcasts and building out this thing for nobody. And I sent it around to my friends and people I know. And everybody was like,
what?
Like some of them read it. A couple of them were like, wait, what are you doing? And so then I was sitting and I do video production for a living. And so, you know,
you used to be in front of the camera and now you're more behind the camera. Is that right?
Yeah. Yeah, totally. Yep. I was a TV reporter for 10 years and, a lifetime ago. And then
for 15 years, I've been running my own video production company. And so I have some, you know, ability to make videos and just shooting them right there in my office, and just figured like, hey, nobody's reading this paper. Everybody's listening to podcasts, maybe a podcast. And
so hell of a way to spend the apocalypse. So how old are your kids, John?
My kids are 18. I have boy, girl twins.
Nice. 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 Great. I got a 28 and a 22. I got boy, girl, not twins.
Yeah, exactly.
Our audience is all saying hi to you. I'm now putting the comments on the stream, and so we obviously have, I don't know that you could even go on a show anywhere in the world and have more people in the audience who understood your point of view or had studied your work more. So this is kind of exciting for all of us. We've really been looking forward to having you on here. I got a lot of thoughts. I want yours too, because, you know, I mean, you're very conversational in your podcasts. Obviously you edit them very professionally, so it doesn't feel edited. Like in our world, when we do edits, it's all jump cuts. And so they're over here. It's very disconcerting. We don't notice your jump cuts. And thank you for that. We're not getting seasick.
That's right. I'm an old TV guy.
Well, look, there's nothing, you know, what a great way to, again, spend this time in our world. I said it in my book. I started this, or I put my first chapters online a year ago. And it's, as I say, it's the least and the best I could do. I got two kids. That's like my pact with the universe that I want the world to go on after I'm dead, which could be really, really soon. And that's one of the things that I'm struggling with right now, John, is that, so we're just going to jump right into it, because you're a dad, I'm a dad. We're both fucking old, at least old enough that, you know, we've lived a pretty good amount of life. It would be no tragedy when, you know, it is a tragedy. I lost my best friend in the world who was my age, and I'm only 55. So believe me, I'm not saying it's not a tragedy, but you get to a certain age, you come to terms with the fact that you're immortal. We do not come to terms with the fact that our children are mortal or that the human race is going to end on our watch. Yet that's what we're facing right now, John.
Yeah. It's unthinkable. It's insane. It's nuts. It's so real. You know, one of the hardest things about this whole thing that I try to talk to people about is the ability to imagine what you can't imagine. Right? Like you look out your window and you're like, what would it look like the day after all the humans were made extinct? What would my house look like? What would my street look like?
That's right. In fact, one of the first things I have to get into the book is such a basic level of consciousness. Like, what are we beside our thoughts? Because in a lot of ways, or in all ways, our thoughts are illusions in our mind. Well, so is AI. AI is an illusion in our world. And so if we can't start to process the difference between our ego, who wants more money and more stuff and wants to be successful and wants to have a partner of our choosing and may want to have children or anything like that, those are all very normal human ego things. But if the world is not around in 2 years and there is no human history, there's just a smoking, non-smoking black hole in the universe somewhere, going to be called kind of hollow accomplishments. And John, I keep saying to people, the money that you're earning right now has never been less valuable than it is today. The only thing you can do is to fight for your human survival, which means protecting yourself against what's to come. And so here's how I look at it, John. This is really hard for me to say. It's hard for me to say to my parents and my kids. My parents are still alive, both at 82. I don't see myself, I feel like I've got a death sentence. I don't see myself alive within a year. I will lead the charge against this and somebody will just rub me out. But I ain't worried about calories. I may take up more smoking. I mean, look, I'm already dead. This shit is so bad. And I'm telling you, man, I told my adult kids too, I want them to grow up. I don't see it happening. I see myself as a person with a death sentence right now. And so I have very little fear, John, and I have very honest conversations that most people are afraid to have, because I've been working on this. I started this stuff. I called it before anybody. There's nobody that called the singularity a year ago and outed all this stuff like I did, and I haven't had to retract a single thing
because we're the first best victims. We have been fleeced by AI. United Healthcare has AI that denies 90% of health claims. It's invalid AI software, and they employed it since 2019. So, John, well, how about 2019. This?
Yeah.
Killing people with AI. I believe 2019. That.
We didn't need AI to have insurance companies, willing to not pay claims. I'll tell you just a quick story. My mother worked in the 1950s in St. Louis at American General Insurance in a giant room with 1,000 desks. And they would
AGI,
open up
AGI, baby.
Send their claims, right? People would send their claims in and handwritten notes. I've been paying my premium for 40 years. I broke my leg. Here's the hospital bill. Will you pay it? The company policy was, unless they explicitly write, this is my fifth time I've written you, the letter goes straight in the trash.
Yep. There. Hey, that's
thousands of women in the room opening up envelopes. Unless it said this is the fifth time I've written you, straight in the trash.
So this is that's a perfect point, because what I've tried to describe to people is this is the ultimate realization of corporate fraud put into the form of black box AI. So all we get is an output, which as Roman Yampolsky so well described, he's one of my first sources in the book, by the way. So I got good sources. So do you. And as he described, there's a dual impossibility scenario, which I tell people all the time, right? It can't be understood, and it can't be explained, even if it was understood by somebody. And so we are trapped in this world already, as you said, where we have now automated the trash can with AI, but that AI is plausible deniability. So instead of CEOs and CFOs and all these and medical doctors going to prison for denying valid medical claims, they're just going to pay people billions of dollars. They don't care. They print money. It's the largest healthcare provider in the United States. And they have been using known faulty software since 2019. So it's the ultimate corporate predation. It's the ultimate in deniability, because software did it. AI did it. AI denied the claims. It's not us. And just like our gig economy right now, and just like the financial markets, where our money supply is gone. Well, technology, this is arbitrage. People are buying things and selling them at a higher price. And we're labor, so we just get driven lower and lower. That's just the way it goes. No, that's all AI driven. The fact that we don't have jobs and we're in the gig economy, that's because all of our resumes that we've sent in for the last 10 years all go in the round file. They're only hiring their friends. The rest is just for show. We know this. The job companies, the job search companies,
Yep. But I'll tell you, it's a little bit of human nature too, right? I had
it's codified.
I knew a news director at a TV news station who would literally have 300 tapes on his desk. And, post the job, get the tapes before he looked at a single tape, put them into two piles arbitrarily, put one pile in the trash and said, I don't hire unlucky people.
That's right. And I saw the same thing in the corporate world. That's what I told everybody. It's like, you think when they pick the winner out of a hat for whoever wins the Apple computer, it's not one of their friends? Because it is. It's one of their friends. It's somebody they know, or because there's no rules, man. There's no rules unless somebody's watching. And so they built these AI systems with no rules, because it's unauditable.
Correct. Not even by
I have to make up. I don't even know if that word existed, because inauditable, it would be like one word, but it's unable to be audited. All of it. We're trusting them, which is the worst bet.
Yeah. Hey, can we talk about this real quick? This question I see here in the comments from Sinful Toaster here. It surprised a lot of parents I talk to about the future, don't care about it more. This has really been on my mind, and the next show, one of the next shows I'm going to do is just sitting down with a group of moms and just talking to them, but have them watch the first show and react. Parents would do anything for their kids, right? Parents would die with a smile on their face to save their child's life. Where is that instinct in this conversation?
Well, what I was working up to with my, the roundhouse kick to the lower class and the lower middle class, because now we are now the middle class and lower class all compressed together. We all live in the sewer down here. This is a sewer morning show for the sewer.
And so we all live here together because there is no middle class anymore. Everybody that used to be in the middle class is now, we're all in the same space, which is desperately hoping to survive whatever's coming next. So, but we are the first best victims. And this is what I wanted to tell you about. And this goes to the mother thing, is that people, there's a couple principles, right? People won't learn what is against their pocketbook, right? And so we've got a whole bunch of old timers here in a pyramid scheme who don't want to learn what's coming because they profited from the old pyramid scheme. And if the world turns upside down, they don't get to be on the top of the pyramid anymore. So that's the primary driver, is the sellouts of our own human race, all the way, of course, up to the people that, you know, whoever the 50 people in the world that are designing the next level AI and taking jobs, you know, at $800,000 a year starting salary. Whoever those people are, right? They're at the top of another pyramid, but the pyramid that's been here for humanity is all getting thrown up in the air again, right? And so the people that are selling out the human race to the very end, well, those are the same people with the soccer moms and with the minivans and everything, and they want to consume until the end. And you have the same problem that I have starting in the book, is how do you have that conversation until people are woken up and conscious of the fact there is of their place in the world? Because if you have that with an unconscious person, again, how do they visualize something they can't even conceptualize?
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. There's like a possibility bias or something.
Well, that's what my book's about. My book is not for gig workers. My book is for everybody to understand what this is. And gig work is the first best example, because they didn't tell us, Uber, Lyft, DoorDash, all these, they didn't tell us we were working for AI. They told us that companies cared about us and this was an opportunity. It was flexible. It was this. Well, no, it was just all selling us into this thing. And there's a word that's great, John. It was written by the journalist Cory Doctorow. It's called enshittification. And it's a word for what's happening with AI, is that it starts you up here, right? It welcomes you in. It gets to know you as AI, and it's playing you with 6 million predictions a second, each one of us individually, and then it drives you ever closer to zero as time goes on, and it gaslights you, and it controls you. It's gamblified, so people become addicted to it. This was made to enslave the lower class of the world technologically, and it's been incredibly effective because they did not tell us, right? They told us we were independent. You can't be independent in AI. So we're the most interested customer you've ever seen.
So I'm a little bit of a conspiracy theory skeptic in some ways. Like, for example, something you hear a lot from people is be like, the media decided to do this. The media is doing this. And, you know, someone who worked in newsrooms in three states over 10 years, you know, try saying to your neighbor, what do you want to, let's go to lunch, what do you want to get? And then invite the next neighbor. And now you have to three people deciding, and then invite the whole block. And now you have 12 families deciding where you're going to go for lunch. Like, individuals make conspiracies very hard to actually come together. You know, there's way too many individual morons in TV newsrooms to coordinate anything.
That's right. I totally agree with you. And that's where, I guess AI both fits us and deceives us so well, is because it's just AI is just a confirmation bias machine, right? It just confirms our biases until we're just laying in our grave and like, well, we knew we were going to die anyway, and then it's all over. And that kind of feels like what we're doing right now, is just walking down the chute to catch a bolt in the head, because we literally, I mean, again, you're talking to a community right here who is, some people have been working for AI in this community since it started, like even like 10 years ago. And now we have seen it go worse and worse and worse, to where now this community is just living in abject poverty. The cost of our operations, which have all been foisted upon us by the wonders of AI and the transference of risk from the corporate economy. And so we're all choking on our own blood. And they pretend we don't even exist. Tony Hsu did a CNBC Q2 update where they claimed record profits. They talked about starting the grocery business, and they bragged about how now advertising, another layer of Ponzi scheme into their current Ponzi scheme, is leading the way in their record profits. Guess what he did not mention even once? He didn't mention any operations in the field that Dashers even exist. And so we literally, they've dehumanized us to the point where we are looked at as this lower class, this lower caste. And I'm telling you what's happening. We're the first to go in the genocide. When they start wiping people out with AI, they wipe us out because the AI can replace all human labor. Anything that we do for labor can be replaced by AI and will be replaced. They're already taking our value of labor down to zero. So John, you're looking at the community that's like on the front lines of trying not to die first. It's wild.
Well, here's the thing though, and I push back a little bit, like an unaligned AGI system, right, were it made, doesn't care about any of the pink things. Like if China made it, it's not going to protect the Chinese. If the US military makes it, it's not going to protect the Americans.
Same with the gig apps. There's no protection for anybody.
It's not going to target gig workers or rich guys or anybody. It's going to target all the pink squishy things.
Right. And so that's the next level. We're going to be taken out first. We're going to be taken out before that even gets there. They're already taking us out as the first level so that we're gone before you guys have to deal with that, because they're cutting off our ability to live. Tesla is now coming out with a rideshare car, so there will be no more driving jobs. And so literally, this is my theory, is that, I mean, this is why we're the 300. They were at 300 million, we're the 3 billion. We are first in the line to be exterminated. There's no question, because we are the laborers. This isn't just drivers here of rideshare or last mile delivery. We are all the people that used to have jobs and careers somewhere, most of us, in blue-collar industries. Those jobs are gone now forever, and there's nothing coming to replace them. So we're literally going to be left with an economy of moldy Cheetos. Our money supply is gone, our work is gone, and we're going to feed ourselves how? On the goodness of the government? Because around the goodness of the government, if you walk around Portland, it's just people living in tents.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I don't think people talk about this a lot, but if you listen to Sam Altman and the stuff he's been saying for his whole life, you know, he's a big believer in universal basic income. He's a big believer in
making God
some sort of, you know, luxury communist state.
Creating God.
Well, yes, there's that, of course.
Yeah, he wants to create God. So do you know the issue of Sam Altman's sister who accuses him of a lifetime of sexual, emotional, and financial abuse?
Yes, I have read about it.
Have you done any fact checking on that? I've looked into it. It seems pretty legitimate. I don't know. This guy seems like a real unbalanced, dangerous individual to be having the keys to the world.
Yeah, I think that one of the scariest things about him is, I don't know if you've I read a thing about him the other day that was like basically like he is just a force of nature and someone who cannot be denied what he wants. And if you dropped him off on an island of cannibals and came back 5 days later, he'd be the king of the cannibals eating steak.
That's great. That's what we need more of for sure, John. We needed ourselves another crazy maniac dictator. That's what we needed. Yeah. Okay. So because you asked, I liked when you asked Roman that, you said, you know, how do you think Sam sleeps at night? And Roman, like a great scientist, but like I could have no concept of that. Nor could I. But I do think that it is absolutely worth noting over the last week, all this drama, multiple CEOs for OpenAI, like the Death Star don't have no captain right now. It's kind of floating in space. It went from being a nonprofit to now with a massive for-profit arm that really runs the thing. And the nonprofit people wanted to stick to a mission. And Sam Altman wants to create God or be God or live forever. Boy, yeah. It's dicey out there.
I have thoughts about that. I don't know if you've done any research on what Sam did at Reddit, but basically my thoughts have been shifting about what actually happened at OpenAI. Here's where I am right now. I think that very likely Sam Altman orchestrated the entire thing to consolidate power and get the safety conscious board members off the board. And so, you know, he knew he was going to get fired. He planned it. He knew he was going to get rehired. He knew he basically in his past has set up these dramas where all of a sudden his 20% becomes 80% of a company because the CEO had something bad happen and the board had to step in and he's the chair of the board and blah, 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 blah.
Look, John, people fall out windows sometimes, John. Sometimes people just fall out windows.
Yeah.
Well, to point out what you're saying, a nonprofit board has very different powers and obligations than a for-profit board. And what you're talking about, and again, we've been talking about it on the show a little bit, that change in structure, it was the nonprofit board that had the conflict. Now most of them are out the door. So now there's nobody standing in the way. And I don't, again, this nonprofit, for-profit thing, they pulled so much shenanigans on this thing that was going to be OpenAI. And now it's owned 49% by Microsoft and 51% by Satan or something like that.
Yeah. Yeah. Yep. And so the question that, you know, I'm sure you've read about this Q-Star thing and what, you know, what happened with that. And is, you know, I think that sounds kind of real. I think they probably did make some big advances. I think the big advances probably did scare the shit out of them. And they said, oh, you know, had some disagreements internally about what the fuck do we do with this advance we've made? You know, all these are ingredients in what happened, I feel like.
I've been saying since the start, this is a small group of people playing with nuclear bombs in a lab. They know what they're doing. Some of them drunk the Kool-Aid, some of them don't give a fuck and are just like ready to see out the end of the world in any way that it comes. Some of them are just megalomaniacs that think they're going to outsurvive us in their nuclear airplane and their New Zealand bunker, but none of them are good. None of them are good.
Yeah. I mean, I don't, you know, that this is a great place where like the disconnect is, right? So these are a bunch of super rich people. They all have kids for the most part. Like they should have beautiful lives, multi-generational wealth waiting for their family to.
My kid, Omega Prime. You're talking about my kid, Omega Prime.
And so, you know, like, how do you spend money if we're all dead? How do you,
can't even spend, you can't, we can't even spend our moldy Cheetos down here if we're all dead.
Yeah. Yeah. That's something like, you know, like we talked about it with Roman and he, in the first interview episode, when he talks about talking to his kids and his kids say, I don't understand it. That doesn't sound like something that's in your self-interest. Like, yeah, what the fuck?
So I got a confidential, there's not very many people in the world that do this level of AI. And I got a confidential interview with one of them. And basically, it seemed like a terrified for their life type of situation. And I suppose if you're working at $1 million a year, that it probably is like one of them fucking movies where you're in the firm and you just better not fuck things up.
Yeah. I've done this. I started the For Humanity Pod Twitter X account, and I'm following like a couple hundred OpenAI employees. They're all out there, and they're all chatty as shit out there.
Mm-hmm.
Kool-Aid chatter. And so I've started poking them. Just, you know, these are people with a couple hundred followers. They're real people that are walking in that building every day. So just hitting them direct, like, hey, a cool tweet about, you know, it's so great to work here.
So cool that you're developing God. How's that going?
You know, just checking real quick, when did I give you permission to risk my kid's future?
Yeah. You get any good answers?
Yeah, no. No.
No.
Not at all.
No, they're not real brave. They're making a lot of money. So it's the same thing. Have you heard of dark patterns, John? Okay, this is great. So I'm gonna publish, this will be published in my book, but so dark patterns, I've already written about it on Twitter and stuff. So dark patterns are what this, by inside source from the AI design world taught me. And so a dark pattern is anything that takes a user in the opposite direction of what is in their best interest or their intentions. Hmm. And so with AI, people are used to the internet where I click on Google and I want to go here and it shows me this, shows me this, shows me that. But with AI, what comes in is dark patterns. And so the AI takes you in a direction that you don't want to go. So if you're, and things like dark patterns is like a 27 page user agreement on your smartphone, right? That's a dark pattern because no human can agree to a 27 page agreement on their smartphone, you know, without consulting a lawyer and whatever else. And we do this stuff all the time. And so that's part of it. But other things are like we see in the gig apps, where it's things that are done to trick us, to log us out, to make us do the wrong thing, to make us accept something we didn't want to accept, or to gaslight us, or to use us basically as free slave labor to park or use or gaslight as we need. And then they tell people they're independent, but there's no independence at all. Everything is literally scripted. Everything that's happening is being served up to each individual person. But here's the wild thing. You guys talked, I loved it, number four podcast, I think you talked about informed consent. And I've been using the same analysis. You know, you're a dad, I'm a dad. You talk about informed consent, right? There are things that happen with human beings, medical care, sexuality, things like that, you know, our personal being that require our informed consent. I just can't grab you and do a medical test on you. I can't just grab you and put you in a social situation you don't want to be in. But that's exactly what every single gig app company did in the world, because they never told anybody that they were working for AI, that they could be fired by AI, hired by AI, denied medical care by AI, denied work by AI at any moment, any of these things. And so as people are finding that out, they're scratching their head. Now some of them are going, well, it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter, it's all working and it's gonna be here forever. This is how it is now. And I said, you know, this is one of the things I keep going. It's like you're about the same age as me. I'm 55, John, you're
48.
Okay, yeah, you look much better than me. I figured you're younger. So anyway, this is one of the things that we have to describe. Like 20 years ago, if somebody took this gig app scam of the gig economy that they're running on the impoverished people of the world and put it in the news, it would be a 60-minute scandal, everything else. But they've thrown in the towel. There's now Portland is just covered in graffiti with people living in tents. Nobody cares anymore, right? We put boulders down under bridges so people can't sleep there.
Roman talks about, he has a great bite about cars. And he's like, so, you know, if we didn't have cars and we introduced them today and they said the cost of cars is 100,000 people dying on the highways every year, everyone would be like, fuck no, we don't want these fucking cars. But right. He's like, you know, it's just been sort of boil the frog grandfathered in. Like, that's the cost of
cost, you know, doing business.
Pizza is 100,000 people dying a year. Oh, well.
Yeah, and that's the cost. That's the cost of the gig economy is enslaving humanity to AI without informed consent, without fair wages, with ever decreasing.
Well, hey, if it makes you feel any better, everybody else is in line right behind you.
Yeah, it doesn't. It doesn't. It doesn't. I gave up on me a long time ago. I just want my kids to live their natural lifespan, man. That's like my goal in life, is my kids to live their natural lifespan, and I I'm like. And at the very least, I get to go first. I get to go fucking first. I'm first in line. When they got to take people out, I'm getting first. I don't want to watch all you guys get hurt. I don't want to watch all you young people get hurt.
Somebody said it's tragic. In the comments that is interesting, I think, which is like, a part of this is like trying to convince everyone to care about this without making them want to jump off the top of a building.
Like, it really is. And that scared me in my book. It scared me in this whole project. It's taken me, John, what do you say, friends in this community? I think I broke into this community when I broke the story. So what broke my writing into this community, I've been in the scientific and academic and civil rights side of the writing world. But I did gig work myself during the pandemic. And chose to do what's now a 3.5-year project on this, and I saw this slavery and societal decay from AI coming on this, and then, you know, OpenAI and the AGI has really kind of jumped in the middle and made it even a bigger deal, and then we in the gig economy here. People just kind of have started to figure out since July that they're working for AI and they've been lied to and they've been capped and they've been manipulated and they've been enslaved. And now, again, with, you know, Cory Doctorow's term gentrification, it's taken them down to sub-poverty levels where it's unsurvivable. And now, of course, we see the news that Tesla's coming out with its own self-driving rideshare car, and we won't have even gig apps to work in. So we're in big trouble in this community, John.
Yeah. I feel you. You know, I think it's only, I think it's going to push out onto a lot of different levels too. Like what happens when all the accountants and lawyers lose their jobs? That's real.
Lawyers are already much like college applications. Lawyers there are already surreptitiously using OpenAI illegally. And as we've seen in stories, it makes up false cases. So that's the problem with AI is that it, you know, this is that alignment problem that you talked about. Nobody has been able to figure out how to take the humanity out of the AI, which means that it's an exploitation machine.
Right. Well, so this gets to this Q-Star stuff. This is kind of crazy, right? So all the LLM systems only process text, right?
And large language models
only process text. It's a text predictor. You give 1,000 words and it'll predict 1,000 at first word. So it can't do math, right? Because the difference between math and text prediction is in text prediction, there's any number of possible right answers.
Right.
You know? The 1,001st word could be a lot of different things. In math, there's only one correct answer. So what I have read that is pretty freaky is that what happened at OpenAI that caused all this was this Q-Star thing that basically they figured out how to do it, make it do math. It did elementary school level math, and then they really freaked the fuck out because it started doing what they call novel math, which is math previously unknown to humans, right. And it used the novel math to make to break the most serious level of encryption known in the world. And so this article that I read was basically like OpenAI called up the NSA and were like, I think we broke global encryption.
This is what we've been talking about. Well, security does not exist. Security does not exist. And so now these scams and most of these pyramid schemes, the deeper that they pull you in from the poverty pimps, the more information they want. They want your bank account. They want to be your insurance companies in on this. They're plugged into your car. They got rideshare cams into your car. Yeah. They got your cell phone. They're triangulating you with AI from like 50 different sources. This is the matrices that we're in. We are in a simulation. We're still in real life. You can pinch yourself and it hurts, but we are already operating in a simulation that's being run by computers, not for our benefit. It's a fact.
I've been avoiding the DNA stuff forever. The ancestry, the 1, 2, 3 and me, all that stuff.
I'm with you right there, brother.
She has the whole family tree built out and everything is all done. And I just feel like this last piece of it is like, shit, you could literally could make a digital copy of you, maybe a biological copy of you. I don't know why they'd want to, but.
Those actors, those wealthy folks in Hollywood, they're stupid, but they're not craven. they went on strike to protect their AI images because they see what's going on right here.
Yeah. There's a question here. Do I think it's too late to turn back? And this is where, Jeff, you and I may disagree, but I got to go with no, it's not too late. I think an essential part of being a human is optimism and hope. And I can't live in a world where there's no chance. So I do not think it's too late to turn back.
Even if Eliezer gives us a chance.
Right. Even Eliezer, who is the doomiest of the doom, gives us a 2% chance. So
that's double 1%, by the way. Right. We're in absolute agreement. It's the premise of the book. It's the premise of everything else that it is our obligation and our duty and our only option to stand up against this now, because there will be no other time. It's on us. And the leaders are the people that we're talking to in the audience right now. It's not you and it's not me. We're old guys that can keep yak pretty good, and some of us can edit video good, and some of us write okay, and stuff like that. But we're not the leaders. The leaders are in this community. These are the people who have been the victims of it, and they have to decide whether they want to be free from it or not. If they're going to walk into the cage, if they're going to walk down the chute, then we're done. That's why these people are my heroes. That's why I get up every day, because I'm with you, John. I'm not giving up. I will not quit. We do not have to. We will never give up on our children's lives. But that's why I'm also fearless. And I suppose you should be too. There may be people. Look, there's people with trillions of dollars invested in this. There may be somebody that wants to rub you or me out for the things that we're saying someday. And that's not unlikely, because we're standing in the way of people running a scam on the globe for the rest of the short time that humanity's here. I don't care, John. Like, the only thing that matters right now is that we speak the truth to people that can do something about it. That's our wonderful audience. Thank you all for your service, by the way. What do you think, John?
Yeah, I mean, I see over here in the comments, hope is a dangerous drug. I think hopelessness is even more dangerous. You know,
I can't imagine it. I'm not giving up all my kids are alive.
On hope till my last breath before hitting the pipe of hopelessness. No way.
We have nowhere to go. We have nowhere to go. This is the thing. This is, we're being occupied by technology. We have nowhere to go. We only have our home right here and our local community. And if they take our money supply away and take our technology away, we just need to say wave bye-bye and just have our own community and start bartering and start figuring out how to live and breathe the air that we have left. If we become slaves to technology, it's all over. There is no air to breathe. There is no nothing left. So I'm opting for the fight for human survival and talking to people about what's happening until my very end. I hope you guys last a fucking hell of a lot longer than I do.
Okay, now let's hope we're all here for some time. I mean, it matters. The difference between 1 year, 2 years, 20 years, 30 years, 50 years, 100 years.
That's a big difference. For the rest of humanity, the first 100 million don't count. We started 100 million this one.
Do you believe, Jeff, do you believe the sort of utopian dream stuff that, like, you know, Elie Wiesel says it, if we could, that we're 50, 60 years away from ending disease, poverty, hunger, all of these things are right there. But just as we are perfectly human, we're about to fucking
blow it.
Screw it up.
We're going to coug it.
Yeah.
That's, stop ourselves. But that's Northwest for Washington State. But
it's right there.
But so here's the problem. Here's the problem. And we've noted it from the start, is you said it in your last podcast. It's the conflict of interest. Corporate AI. I came up with the term corporate AI, and in chapter 4 of my book is Will Corporate AI Kill Us? And Eliezer is featured in the book in chapter 4. And the answer is, yeah, probably it will. Because it is corporate AI. All of the AI that has been developed in the world so far has been created to exploit humans, not help humans. Could AI be used to create a utopic society where we used it exclusively for applications that benefited humans? Yeah, that's possible. We'd have to do a lot of studying and make sure we didn't fuck that up too.
Oh my God.
But it's possible, but that's not where the money is. All 100% of the money is in the kill us all category.
This made me crazy. I heard Altman do an interview a week ago. I just watched it last night. And it's like a 30-minute thing at a Bloomberg thing. He's on stage last week talking about, you know, whatever the hell he's talking about. And all he refers to when she talks to him about, like, you know, what are your goals? What are the things? He talks about delighting users. The product is really delighting our users.
So that's the people that are living in the New Zealand bunkers after we're all dead.
No, he's willing to take a risk that all of our children die, not to cure cancer or climate change or end poverty.
Yeah.
Doing it to delight users. The viewers.
Yeah, yeah. Well, the advertising revenues could be through the roof if they're all delighted, John.
Curing cancer could also, you probably sell some cancer cure. You probably sell some climate change cure.
No, the health insurance companies are all a scam. There's no money. The health insurance companies ruin that scam. You can't run a scam on a scam. You can't run organized crime on organized crime. Here's the problem, John. See, I'm an organized crime expert. I see, like, everything's an inside job. Everything's an inside job. OpenAI is an inside job. The finance industry, inside job. Housing industry, inside job.
All that requires a lot of coordination, though, which is where you know, you got two crooks, right? You got two crooks on the corporate board, and they're trying to coordinate their crookery. One of them's going to try to take the other guy's shit.
No, like, coordinating, but they're all, but they're, but they're most, but they're mostly all crooks. I mean, look, they're mostly all crooks, especially at the CEO level. These guys are all approved by BlackRock. Yeah, but they're on the same team.
To truly conspire, you need all the crooks to be aligned with each other. And
conspire on what?
You know,
what?
Well, anything, any kind of conspiracy, you know, they're well, corporate America is conspiring to do this or that or whatever it is.
Well, like, no, but here's the problem is that for AI, you talked about it with Roman, for AI, you only need 50 people to conspire to end the world. You might only need one. You might only need one guy that really knows how to use this program. And he goes, but you know what? I hate my parents so damn much. I'm putting this sucker down. Right?
We're not there yet. You still need hundreds of millions of dollars of compute to play at the frontier level of AI. You know, like you
can't do hundreds of millions of dollars. You're just singing their song. They got unlimited money.
I know, but I'm just saying that I can't from my basement do a training run that is going to enable me to create ChatGPT 5 or 6. There's only the
it's for the elite. It's for the elite. But look, Elon Musk wants Tesla to unite with Twitter. So you got your Tesla Twitter, they'll put one of the flamethrowers on it, and then you'll be doing the Tesla Twitter Uber rideshare flamethrower car for the apocalypse. We'll all be long dead. I do believe
one person can pull off a large scale conspiracy. So for like Elon Musk, right? He controls all the satellites. Mm-hmm. And he bought Twitter to control the conversation. So he controls the hardware and the software of global communication.
Well, I mean, US and China basically own global communications. Europe has antitrust laws.
US and China will never agree. Like, here's what we want to do.
Oh, no.
Musk in his boardroom by himself could say, here's what I want to do.
Oh, enter. Yeah. Yeah. I think, look, it's going to be private industry that ends the world. It's going to be. 100%. It's going to be private industry that ends the world, and they wield the power of nations anyway. We talk about this in now OpenAI again. They're doing financial shenanigans, but in the gig app space, all of the major players, all of the major monopolists, not only are they monopolists, but they're all owned by BlackRock and Vanguard and State Street and Saudi Arabia and China. Like literally, none of this is American production or money. All these gig apps are is a parasite. They're just an AI parasite, but they came in during a pandemic when everybody had their head down into their cell phone and they walked us right into it. And I mean, that's where this is the one thing. And I don't know, what do you think? I don't know if it's like this with AGI, but for gig apps, our trajectory of the human race changed for what we call app slavery in this community with the pandemic, because in no other scenario would corporate America have tried to take all of these services into rural and suburban America because they're not profitable. But the pandemic walked America right into it. It's very uncanny how it turned out. It didn't turn out well. I think probably the pandemic also had a lot to do with the downfall of a lot of restaurants, corporate America, and everything else. It just opens up more desperation to be willing to risk the American economy and the human race on AI.
Yeah. How about this? I'll tell you this, Jeff. There's one argument that I've heard, one that I think defeats all of our arguments. There's only one. And the anti-AI, it's going to kill us all stuff. And that is if you say the climate change is so urgent that this time scale on climate change is even before AI. So say AI is a 50-year problem and climate change is a 30-year problem. And, you know, we're going to have 2 feet of seawater in all the cities in 10 years. And the only way to, you know, we as a people have neither the political will nor the technological know-how to solve climate change on our own. The only way we're going to solve climate change is with AGI. I believe that. I believe that. You know, we can't get our politics together and we don't know enough about physics to really solve this problem. So you get the unknown laws of physics with the most persuasive force in the history of Earth, and you can save the planet. But happened first, maybe there's a case to be made for we need to make AGI to solve climate change because we're all going to die from that anyway in like a 50 to 150 year range ish.
Yeah. What, I mean, we could also, what if we figured out that, like, what if AGI determines that 10 nuclear bombs will do the trick? Where do we drop them?
Oh, absolutely.
Because that's going to be the solution. It's like we came up with it. It's 10 strategic nuclear bombs. We'll fix the global warming problem. It's like, poof, congratulations, you fixed global warming.
Yeah, totally. There's no more... there's no more travel of any kind on a something with an engine.
Yeah, right. Exactly. You're
walkers.
A horse and a buggy. Well, this is one of the things that we say over and over. Any AI that can employ you can also unemploy you. Any AI that can give you the right to drive can take away your right to drive. Any AI that can give you the right to get an income can take away that right to get an income. And we're having that already. There's no fairness in being fired by AI or in being not hired by AI because there's no humans involved. We're just all digital widgets. This is the thing that, you know, you're talking to a group of people here that has been dehumanized to the point of slavery by technology. I'm telling you, we're the first best victims. We're going to be your biggest damn fans because we're all going to watch every damn one of your podcasts and take it out to the world because there's millions of us and we're getting killed first. We are.
Yeah.
We love you, John. We love you, John. Thank you. Thank you for everything, all the work.
Go anywhere to anywhere, talk to anybody. Like I'm of the opinion that like, give me one person. And if I can talk to them and convince them that this is important, I've done something in that hour that was worth my while. Where's the next one?
Yep. Well, I want to talk to you offline about my book and stuff because we got the same mission. I ain't in this for the money. I figure I'll be long dead first. You can give it to my kids if they're around, if you're around, if we're around. So we need to talk offline and collaborate because I'll do everything I can to help promote what you're doing.
Awesome.
My only objective, this is a non-monetized channel, by the way, John. We could be monetized, but we're not. So when we share your videos and everything, we're not. You're in no way ever profiting from anything you're doing. Although I think you're like me. It's like, hey, if we save the human race, you can have the $2.
Yeah.
Yeah. I have it.
Your eyeballs. That's all.
Yeah. I yeah. Yeah. Well, that's what you got our hearts and minds. We're the 300. I'm telling you, there's another show, a guy named Jeff, different Jeff. I'm JTB. He's Jeff. Uber Jeep Arizona is his name, and you should check out his channel for your research because he is also, he's on the rideshare side where I studied DoorDash and all of this side and kind of the overall artificial intelligence. He's really a driver advocate and a driver, and they're ready for revolt. They've been taken down to nothing. They're basically ready to start passing out their business cards and just go, don't call Uber anymore, just call us, we're done. So wow. this thing's going down, John, and you're going to be at the center of it. Congratulations, welcome to our community.
Awesome. It's great, great to talk with you. Great to, you know, interact with everybody online. I appreciate all your questions and
I hope you'll come in again.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Okay, good. Well, I will be in touch with you, John. I'd love to have a chance to talk with you offline. If anybody has any questions for John before he goes, do you have time for a question or two?
Yeah, I'll take a question or two, sure.
Yeah, if anybody's got a question, go ahead and throw it in the chat. John's, this very podcast that we just watched, it's linked in the show notes for this show, so you can go watch the whole thing yourself. Subscribe to John's channel. Most absolutely. Here it is. Actually, we can watch that if I know where I is. Here we go. So this is John's channel right here. This is the For Humanity podcast. John is the host. He's got some great trailers. If you want to just share something with family member for a couple minutes. I mean, one of the things we talk about, John, is that we have to be the people that teach other people. That's what this show is about, is people learning, sharing. If you got adult kids, if you got teenage kids, if you got a family that you think might want to join this fight to stay alive, I'd share this podcast. I think it's really well titled, John. I love the For Humanity podcast.
Thank you. Yeah, I see one question here. Who's controlling Sam Altman? I don't know, man. I don't know. I feel like he might be doing his own thing for his own crazy reasons. Like, you know, I feel like these guys believe that it's inevitable. that this is going to happen. And so they're like, if not me, who? There's some chance that I make God and become a God controller. So shit, let's spin the wheel.
He said those very frightening words himself. So it's not us. It's not us making up hyperbole.
Yeah.
I wish it was.
Someone who I would encourage everybody to check out is Connor Leahy. I think he's the CEO of Conjecture, which is a British AI company that is only working on alignment research. And he, I think, is probably the best articulator of these issues and topics of anybody in the game.
Connor's got the Connor's got kind of the longest hair in the beard.
Yeah, he's
kind of
like 30. Yeah, he went on Bankless, which is like a crypto podcast.
Yeah, we watched the full full Eliezer interview on Bankless. That's in my book.
Watch Connor on Bankless because he blew their minds. And he, I think, he came before Eliezer. He came on and they were like, you know, we're gonna talk about how AI affects crypto. And within like 5 minutes, that whole show was scuttled. And the entire show was about existential risk. And they
The same thing happened with Eliezer. It's like, we didn't talk about crypto at all. It's like, and the guys looked, they were shell-shocked. And I put that in the book. I mean, I put a content warning on that for real. I tell people, like, if you are struggling with suicidal ideations and things like that, you need to be really careful with this information because it is so very sobering to hear some of the smartest people in the world talk about the threat to our children growing up. I mean, this is no joke, folks. This is just the hardest, most awful stuff. I never thought I'd be, you know, sitting on the air talking to my friends at 55 thinking like, yeah, I probably won't see 56.
Yeah. Yeah.
So,
yeah. Well, so if y'all subscribe, get your friends to subscribe. And as you're making the case for this stuff, like if you have a buddy that you talk to occasionally and you're like, you know, I've been telling you this stuff, they're not getting it, just send them episode one, see what the fuck happens.
Exactly. That's what I'm saying. He's got some previews in there. Even the previews are like 2 minutes long, but they tell a very compelling story where anybody's going to want to hear more. So John, we'll have you back. We'll have you back early and often, and we're gonna follow up on Connor on the Bankless podcast as well. Thanks so much for your time and for everything that you're doing for the community, John.
Absolutely. Thank you, Jeff. Thank you all. Everybody have a great week.
Thank you, John. Have a great afternoon.
Okay, thanks. See you. Bye-bye.
Well, that was great. Thank you so much, John Sherman. Thank you, friends, audience, for being part of that. Great opportunity to talk to somebody that's got wonderful viewpoints. And I you know, if my self-criticism there, I probably should have said it with John on. There were things I wanted John to share his thoughts with us too, but I very much wanted, as you could hear, John to understand where we're coming from as gig economy workers, because I don't think we have been figured into the equation of humanity as the first best victims. And I really wanted John to understand that. And I think I'm real excited that we got to have that conversation. Real excited that we got to have that conversation, because that is going to be key to our potential for success. Yes, it is heavy stuff. Thank you, my friend Bigfoot Dasher, and everybody for doing this whole thing. If anybody has any questions or thoughts you want to throw in there, I'll give them a read for sure. Probably a lot to think about. I hope a lot of you go back and watch this broadcast a second time. I know that I will. I want to hear what John said again, and I might even remember what I said once. But this is important stuff. There's really nothing else that's going to matter unless we take care of what's going on right here in our home, in our neighborhood. We're going to wrap it up today. Thank you. Thank you, everybody. Thank you, John Sherman. It's a beautiful day in this neighborhood, a beautiful day for a neighbor. Would you be mine? Could you be mine? It's a neighborly day in this beauty wood, a neighborly day for a beauty. Could you be mine? Could you be mine? I have always wanted to have a neighbor just like you. I've always wanted to live in a neighborhood with you. So let's make the most of this beautiful day. Since we're together, we might as well say, would you be mine? Would you be mine? Won't you be my neighbor? Won't you please? Won't you please? Please, won't you be my neighbor? Thanks, everybody. Have a great afternoon. Take care of each other. Keep your hope alive. Keep fighting.